Hello again, Jim Lampley in New York. Welcome to our coverage of the United States Football League. Last week, the league went over 3 million in total attendance, a figure it did not reach in all of last year. Today, we're covering three games. New Orleans is at Tampa Bay, both teams chasing Birmingham in the Southern Division. Michigan, losers of five of their last six, still tied for the lead in the Central Division, playing at Los Angeles today with Steve Young. That team still in contention despite a 5-7 record in the Pacific Division. And Oklahoma is at Houston, Oklahoma 6-6, Houston 7-5. Both of those teams still among the three teams which are in contention for the division championship in the Central Division. I'll be keeping you up to date from here as to what is happening in the ball games that you yourself are not seeing. But for more on the game that you will be seeing, let's go now to the respective ballpark that you'll be watching, your announcer at that game, right now.
Preparing for an aerial onslaught at the Astrodome today. Nobody in the USFL goes to the air more than Oklahoma's Doug Williams and Houston's Jim Kelly. They're going to fire it, zip it, chuck it, heave it, lay it out like no two teams in football. Get ready for an offensive explosion. Houston's Gamblers against the Outlaws of Oklahoma. The Central Division standings of the Western Conference, Houston on top alongside Michigan. The Oklahoma Outlaws would like to get back on top of the division standings. We're expecting some wild times at the Old Dome today. I'm Corey McFerrin along with Kevin Kiley. And first of all, Oklahoma is struggling. They have lost four consecutive games by an average of 28 points. As for Houston, they keep rolling up the points. Last week, 48 points, season high against Pittsburgh, number one offensive club in the USFL. And the run-and-shoot offense is still a bit of a mystery to the rest of the teams in the league, aren't they, Kevin?
Well, Corey, they've been telling offensive coordinator Darrell Davis for years you can't run this offense. But for years he's been running it successfully, and now he's running it over the USFL. A league-high 417 yards a game. They can make things happen and put tremendous pressure on defenses.
And the guy that really makes this thing go is a rookie from the University of Miami. His name is Jim Kelly. He's doing things no other rookie in pro football has ever done before.
Kelly has already thrown 28 touchdown passes this season, over 3,600 yards in passing. He can throw, he can run, and he can shoot, and he has support as he gets right here from Ricky Sanders, the number three receiver in the entire USFL. He and Kelly make a lot of offense, but that's not all. Kelly also has the number one receiver in the league, 999 yards in receptions, Richard Johnson. But it's the offensive philosophy, I believe, that makes Houston go. They get behind people. They throw long, they get lots of yardage, and they put a tremendous amount of points on the board. Here's how they do it. Watch the motion man on the left, the X. As he comes across, they stabilize the defense and get a lot of people into that secondary very quickly. They will beat even the best defense in this league.
Kelly's opposite number for Oklahoma, Doug Williams. Everybody knows Doug has perhaps the most powerful arm in all of professional football. He has struggled a little bit this year after coming over from Tampa Bay of the NFL. But last week, threw for four touchdown passes, 378 yards in the air, his best performance this year.
You have to remember that Doug Williams has been with two expansion teams. Tampa Bay was an expansion team when he broke in with him. But without Doug Williams, Tampa Bay was 4-40. With Doug Williams, 33-33, and they missed the 1979 Super Bowl by one game.
The biggest problem this year for Oklahoma, lack of a rushing offense. They think they have solved that a week and a half ago. They signed this man, Ernest Anderson, the star from Oklahoma State.
Ernest Anderson, 1,800 yards plus in 1982 in college. You see a little bit of it there. He's very quick, and he likes to run out of the I formation. The kid ran for over 3,700 yards in college. He did it this way. He's quick, he's mobile, he can catch a pass. He might make Doug Williams a better quarterback.
Folks in Oklahoma excited about Ernest Anderson. And don't forget, a month and a half ago, at Oklahoma, Houston led in that game in the fourth period by 15 points. Oklahoma storms back to tie it at the end of regulation. They go to overtime and win it on a field goal, 31-28. There is a major revenge factor today. Houston and Oklahoma. Kevin, we're going to see some footballs flying today. We're going to be here for all the action, but first let's go back to ABC Sports Control in New York after this message.
Okay, in addition to the three games that we'll be televising today, there is one other game being played in the league. That one matches San Antonio 4-8 against the Washington Federals 2-10. News from the USFL, and it emanates at least indirectly from that Federals franchise. The Miami Herald reported this morning that real estate developer Sherwood Weiser, the new owner of that franchise, has offered University of Miami coach Howard Schnellenberger a contract which would pay him $3 million over the next 5 years and also guarantee him a six-figure income for life. He's presently in the third year of a five-year deal with the University of Miami, which pays him $250,000 a year and allows for a bundle of outside income. University officials have indicated that they will not negotiate to try to keep Schnellenberger on as football coach. There is peril here. This is the 10th job with which Schnellenberger's name has been linked in the past year, but expect an announcement within a week, and if our sources are correct, expect Schnellenberger to accept the job with Weiser's organization. Last night in the USFL, there were 33,194 at Veterans Stadium in Philadelphia as the Philadelphia Stars, the league's hottest team, had Penn State night to honor the Penn State players on their team. They won for the 10th consecutive time to set a league mark, and here's how it looked. The Penn State Stars, well in evidence early, first quarter, if you've seen it, to Scott Fitzke. That one from 13 yards out on the first possession, and business like Philadelphia was up 7-0. Later in the first quarter, David Riley, who's performed so well in recent weeks, went in from 4 yards out, 14-0. Riley was later to injure a shoulder and missed the second half of the ball game. It was 31-6 at the half. In the third quarter, Philly's main man, Kelvin Bryant, went in from 2 yards out to make it 38-6. Bryant ended the night with 121 yards rushing and receiving. Finally, Fucina hit Steve Folsom from 37 yards out to make it 45-6. Fucina, 23 of 30, 302 yards and 3 TDs. Also last night, Arizona beat Denver 41-6. First win ever for the Wranglers over the Gold. Fifth loss in a row for the Gold, and it moves Arizona to within one game in the Pacific Division. That before 21,741 in Tempe. Also last night, 22,030 at Oakland Alameda Coliseum as Oakland won for the fourth consecutive time after the 9 losses with which they started the season. This one, a 29-14 win over the Memphis Showboats. In the first quarter, Tom Newton scored from 1 yard out, and that made it 7-0 favor of the Invaders. Oakland stretched the lead to 10-0 in the second quarter before Walter Lewis ran in from 38 yards out to make it 10-7. Later, Lewis would tear ligaments in his right or throwing hand, and he missed most of the second half for the Memphis Showboats. No telling when he'll be back in action. Before the half, Fred Bassana, of all people, ran in from 1 yard out. That made it 16-7 Oakland at halftime, and the Invaders were able to go on and win the ball game despite giving up this touchdown return to the league's leading kickoff returner, Derek Crawford of the Boats, 97 yards on the opening kickoff of the second half. That made it 16-14. But Oakland, despite having lost their star runner, the hottest runner in the league in recent weeks, Eric Jordan, with an ankle injury, scored again. Bassana to Newton, 2 yards out in the fourth quarter. That made it 23-14. They went on to a 29-14 win. Marcus Quinn picked off 4 passes. Ken Johnson, the backup Boats quarterback, in the fourth quarter. That gives Quinn 11 for the season and gives him the league lead in that category. Also, Friday, Birmingham beat Chicago 41-7 before 8,578 in Soldiers Field. Birmingham still without Joe Cribbs, but they rushed for 216 yards in that game. And incidentally, it's still unclear how the blitz figures in the purchase of a Chicago franchise by White Sox owners Jerry Reinsdorf and Eddie Einhorn, who have indicated it is not necessarily the blitz as presently constituted that they have purchased. Monday night, the Pittsburgh Maulers will be completing the USFL's action for the weekend against the New Jersey Generals in the Meadowlands, and Pittsburgh is up against it. Apparently, both Rozier and Glenn Carano will miss that game with injuries. But we're going to be going back to the ballpark for United States Football League football immediately after this.
ABC Sports presents United States Football League action. Today, it's the Houston Gamblers hosting the Outlaws of Oklahoma. Corey McFerrin along with Kevin Kiley and Jerry Parks, Oklahoma Outlaws, trying to break a 4-game losing streak against the most powerful offensive club in the USFL, the Houston Gamblers. There is Coach Woody Woodenhofer of Oklahoma. He's out to stop a trend, Kevin Kiley, and that trend is this. Their team has been 0-6 in good weather, 6-0 in bad weather, which means I guess we can count a loss, right?
Yeah, well, at least we can count on a good game, hopefully, between Houston and Oklahoma.
Yeah, we certainly hope so today. Oklahoma trying to break that trend. There is a good shot of Jack Pardee on the sideline, head coach of the Houston Gamblers. And the one guy that Woody Woodenhofer is looking for today to help his offense out is a young man by the name of Ernest Anderson out of Oklahoma State University. Let's go now to our man on the sidelines, Jerry Parks. He's with Ernest right now.
And with Ernest Anderson on the sideline, Ernest, this is kind of a come home for you. Your first pro game in the Astrodome, and you're a native of this area. How do you feel coming home?
It's always great to play against, you know, in front of your hometown. It's always nice to see your parents and your relatives and everything else.
Ernest, you played here with Oklahoma State in the Blue Bonnet Bowl. You like this field?
Oh, yes. The Astrodome is a good atmosphere. The fans are, you know, real great, and looking forward to playing in it again today.
Ernest, you're the running back. Do you know how much you're going to play today?
Well, last week I didn't really practice that much. This week I had a great, you know, practice, and I'll see a lot of action this week.
Great. Well, we wish you well. Ernest Anderson, and he is going to be playing a lot for the Outlaws today, Corey.
All right. Thank you very much, Jerry Parks and Ernest Anderson. Oklahoma to receive. Tony Fritsch to kickoff. Lonnie Harris, the deep man, at the 15-yard line. Across the 25, where he's knotted up. First and 10 for Oklahoma at the 27-yard line. A return of 8 yards for Lonnie Harris. Here we go. The offensive backs and receivers for Oklahoma, of course, Doug Williams. 5 years at Tampa Bay. He's the man to watch. Their top receiver is Al Williams. His number is 41. Williams last week put the ball up 48 times. We'll see if he doesn't repeat that today. Lazarus and Sidney Thornton in the backfield for Oklahoma. Williams will throw on the first play. He's going for Lazarus, I believe. No, it is Lazarus out of the backfield for a good game across midfield to the 48-yard line. Tommy Myers forced him out there. 25 yards in the pickup. Take a look at it again, Kevin.
Last week, the Oklahoma Outlaws ran about six times out of 13 on first down, and they used play action there. Got a hole in that defense of Houston. Houston's 17th in the league in pass defense, and that's one of the reasons. On first down, they've got to be a little bit more aware of the passing game.
Ernest Anderson in the game for the first time for Oklahoma alongside of Sidney Thornton. Sidney's been hampered the past several weeks with an ankle injury. The give is to Ernest Anderson. Barrels across for two or three. Kiki Dial there, number 31, getting off the pile. Defensive line for Houston. The guys to watch here, Cleveland Crosby and Pete Caton. They are the co-leaders in sacks for the Gamblers, 9 apiece. Linebackers Hawkins, Diala, and Anthony Brock getting a start today for the first time. Mitchell, Lewis, Eason, and Hall make up the defensive backfield for the Gamblers. 45-yard line for Oklahoma. Thornton and Lazarus in the I formation. Williams to the near side. That's Al Williams, not to be confused with quarterback Doug Williams, who wants to throw. He dumps it out. That is Lazarus. Nothing doing. A great play. Up in the secondary is Mike Mitchell, and there is no gain on the play.
Mitchell had it read all the way. He was keen on Lazarus, who was in the tailback position. He'll go right out to the right to the top of your screen. You can't see Mitchell, but Mitchell's coming already, and a good open field tackle. You get a defensive back that can make a tackle on an offensive back in the open field, and you've got to find.
Sets up the first third down situation of the ballgame, 3rd and 7 for Oklahoma. They've had his second consecutive 300-yard game last week against Tampa Bay. In motion, that's Lonnie Turner. Williams going back across the middle. He's got a man at the 42-yard line, brought down immediately. That was Steptoe. He does not get the first down. Tommy Myers there immediately. And Oklahoma's going to have to kick it away.
It was a well-conceived play here. Doug Williams, as he comes back, he's got motion on that side to your left as you watch the screen. They're trying to get it underneath, and they do. But look at the defense right around the shoulder pads, and that makes the receiver think about it later in the game. Next time he comes across the middle, he might be kind of hunching his shoulders a bit.
Case de Bruyn in the punt for Oklahoma. That is Gerald McNeil for Houston. 13 times he's returned a punt, 91 yards, low kick, going to let it drop. A Houston bounce to about the 18-yard line, make it the 19-yard line, and that is where Jim Kelly and the Gamblers will take it over. Oklahoma and Houston, no score. We've just begun at the Astrodome. Back at the Astrodome, Houston with its first offensive series coming up. There is Jim Kelly and a look at some gaudy statistics. 28 touchdown passes, breaking the record set last year by Bobby Hebert of Michigan. Kelly is simply on a roll. First play, going to throw it. He does it. Left side, that is Gerald McNeil. The ball is loose. I believe it's an incomplete pass. Barry Copeland was there to punch him real hard. It'll be second down for Kelly. There's the offensive setup. Todd Fowler, the only running back you will find. No tight end here in this offense. Two slot backs. Richard Johnson, number one receiver in the USFL. And, of course, Ricky Sanders, number three. You got Dawson, Boucher, Khalil, Kidd, and Robeson. That's your offensive line for Houston. And they have had an offensive rushing attack the last couple of weeks that has really surprised some people. Todd Fowler, two successive 100-yard games. We'll see if that pattern doesn't continue today. This is Kelly. Got a man over the middle. That's Johnson. Hit him in the hands. I think he might have taken his eyes off the ball very briefly. That's not the kind of play you see from Johnson very often, is it, Kevin?
Dewey McClain was bearing down on him. There you see the defensive line of Oklahoma, Anderson, Nelson, and Rule. And Dewey McClain is a linebacker that has, right there, you see him, outside linebacker, has a lot of experience. And that experience was about to lower the boom on Johnson on that play. McMillan, Copeland, Williams, Middleton in the defensive backfield. This is a pretty good defense. They were known early when they were successful as a defensive team, when they were 6-2. Defense has come apart a little bit in the last few weeks, and they're looking for some improvement.
Greg Mosier, wide receiver near side. That is Sanders in motion. Kelly going long. He's got a man. That is Mosier. Big play down to the 41-yard line. Rod McMillan makes the stop. And there you see the offense that Kelly and the Gamblers are capable of.
This is a reading offense. Now, what Mosier has to do is read the defensive back, and then Kelly reads Mosier. What Mosier has seen is a seam right up the field. As you can see, that's where Kelly throws it. He takes that back to the middle there on a little bit of a post pattern, and it's goodbye, Charlie. If that ball was thrown out there a little further, it was
right.
TD.
Greg Mosier, now the University of Oregon, is the team's number three receiver. Three touchdowns so far this year. Clarence Verdan in the ball game. That is Johnson in motion. Kelly going left side. Pumps once. Got all kinds of time. Now he's in trouble. And now he throws long. He's got Johnson. Touchdown, Houston. Jim Kelly with all kinds of time. 41-yard connection. And Richard Johnson is now the all-time leader in pass receptions in USFL history.
Not bad defense here. As you can see, they force Kelly out of the pocket here. The only thing they don't do is get to him. Defensive coverage just too long before they get to Kelly. It breaks down. And what Kelly does there, which is great, is he lobs the ball at Johnson and leads him perfectly on a broken pattern. And that's touchdown Houston at home.
We are off and running at the Astrodome. This is Tony Fritsch. Going to try to make it 7-0. He does not do so. Blocked. There's some discussion now. Perhaps it was blocked and went over the crossbar. Fritsch is complaining. It looked kind of like that to us up here in the booth. The referee said no good.
It was very close.
I think it just about went through. Let's see what they're going to say.
It was very, very close. I was thinking as I watched the video on this thing that it might have gone through, but he called it immediately. I think when he saw it was blocked, the referee just instinctively gave it. Yep.
Yeah.
It's good. Let's take a look at
it, Kevin.
It's a helicopter as they hit it. It's going side to side. Sure, it's good by at least 6 inches. Way good.
That's all that matters, 6 inches. Wow. It is 7-0. Houston in command. We're off to a quick start. Back with more football at the Astrodome in just a moment. Jim Kelly continues to bombard the USFL scoring and passing records. He's now 3 of 4, 81 yards, got a touchdown, and Tony Fritz is about to kick it off to this man, Lonnie Harris, number 82. Lonnie, interesting guy, lost three toes in an accident with a lawnmower at the age of 12. Never said he'd be able to play football, but he's doing a heck of a job, and there, breaks one off past the 35. They're going to say he went out at the 33-yard line. He has quickly become Oklahoma's number one return, kickoff return, and punt return man.
Could you imagine if he had five toes, what he could have?
24-yard return.
Well, he had
right
a tryout.
By the red mark.
Lonnie Harris had a tryout with the Washington Federals, and believe it or not, you know what happened to him? He was injured. You know what happened?
I think he broke his toe, right?
He broke one of the two that was left. It's kind of a little bit macabre, but...
Oklahoma and Doug Williams, first and 10, their own 34-yard line, their second possession of the ball game. Houston leads it 7-0 with 10:19 to go here in the first quarter of play. Again, Houston in great field position, and Ernest Anderson on the second carry of the day coughs up the football in his hometown debut. He can't feel very good about that.
Psychologically, this can be devastating for a team. They're looking for a big game out of Ernest Anderson. He had a problem fumbling the ball. You see the helmet right on the ball. Oh, not really Ernest's fault. He had two hands on it, and they teach you defensively, if you get a shot at that ball with your helmet, you take a pop at it and see if you can knock it loose. It was a good tackle and really great defense on Ernest Anderson. Not his fault. Tough to hold on to that thing when somebody hits you like that.
Jim Kelly back at the controls. He's on the 36-yard line. That is Sanders in motion. He's going long. That is Johnson again, incomplete at the 2-yard line.
You don't even go for popcorn in one of these games. You don't dare get anything to eat against Houston. Johnson, very, very exciting receiver. His statistics, number one in the league, speak for themselves. Remember, in this offense, they read and go the opposite way the defensive back goes. Much like basketball, you take the path of least resistance. Johnson has done that. You see he's got the back behind him there. As soon as that back turned, he went. Maybe should have caught that ball, Johnson. He's dropped two today. And I guess if he caught everything, though, he'd be,
he'd be out of his league, that's for sure, yeah. Kelly has Mosier to the near side. McNeil, top of your screen. Sanders in motion. They're going to give it out to Todd Fowler. Fowler some room. 20-yard line. He may go all the way. Gets a block. 10, 5, touchdown, Houston. Wow. We've got 9:41 to go in the first period. Houston's already scored two touchdowns, 36 yards. Kelly flipping it off here to Todd Fowler.
It's a blitz, and it was the perfect call. A little slip screen to Fowler. Take a look at Kidd, number 61. Watch this block. Just destroys the man, and Fowler walks in. Very, very tough on Oklahoma to get points scored on him early like this.
As we mentioned at the outset, they've lost their last four ball games by an average of 28 points in Houston. Trying to make sure that trend continues. Fritz the extra point. This time, nobody is there with a hand. It is good. No questions about it. And the Gamblers lead 14-0. The crowd here at the Astrodome enjoying the treat so far. Gamblers in front. We'll see if Oklahoma can't come back. Other scores around the league today. Tampa Bay's Bandits out in front of the Breakers, 7-0. That's a first quarter score. And I'll tell you what, we're seeing some kind of action already here. Gunslingers lead the Federals 7-0. That came in the first quarter of play. Again, Fritz was his third kickoff of the afternoon. Oklahoma barreling across there at the 42-yard line. 17-yard return there.
Excuse me, Corey. I used to play the up back on the wedge there, and they used to tell us, if you do get your hands on it, pitch it back to the return man. But I've never met one guy in the wedge that ever pitched it back to the return man. We always kept the ball in spite of our instructions and tried to run it.
That's natural. I think that was Ted Sample. with that return. So Oklahoma's going to try it again. Their own 41-yard line. We've had two touchdowns in the first 2:06. Kelly with two touchdown passes. He now has 30 on the year. Williams, some pressure. He's going long. Going for Williams. He falls down. It is intercepted. That is Eason. Make it Will Lewis at the 20-yard line, the 25-yard line. I'll tell you what, nothing going right for Oklahoma. A turnover on their second possession, a turnover on their third possession. Houston has the ball back, and when things are going bad, they just get worse.
This man was never open. Williams just threw the ball up. Look at the coverage. In fact, the offensive player runs into the defensive player. That's why there's no call. He goes down, and that's the result. We've got an interception. Houston has the ball again, and if there's anything you don't want to see playing the Gamblers, it's them with the ball.
I wonder if Houston's defense is wondering if they're going to be on the field today, huh?
Would you please watch the ineligible downfield?
So Kelly and company once again on offense, 26-yard line. Draw play, Fowler. Right side, not much. Hits about three. Fowler, an interesting story. We saw him play, Kevin, 2 weeks ago against Michigan. Up to that point, he'd rushed for something like 130 yards. Had more than 140 that day. Last week, another 100-yard game. He's got more than 400. He has really come on. And Miles Davis told us last night, if he had to pick one guy as the toughest, meanest, most competitive player on the whole team, he would pick Todd Fowler.
Fowler is the beneficiary, I think, of a passing offense. He runs a lot of draw plays, and he gets draw play is a big yardage play. Usually you get 6-7 yards even if you don't get a first down.
Second and five. Kelly over the middle. Nice catch out there. That is Sanders. Good job. Down to the 44-yard line. Sanders comes in the ballgame, the number three receiver in the USFL. He's a good one.
Eight catches, 227 yards last week. As you see, 67 receptions. That'd be good enough to lead most leagues at this point in the year. And he's so far behind his own teammate, Johnson, that he has no chance of catching.
Fastest guy on the team, his speed, they tell us, is 4.28, and that is moving.
I've had cars that didn't go that fast.
I couldn't do it in my car, I know that. First down, Houston, their own 45-yard line. They give it to Fowler. He bowls his way across midfield. Darrell Goodloe is there to bring him down.
I'll tell you something. What this offense does to a linebacker, it makes him sit back on his heels. As a linebacker, you want to lean up. Now watch Beeson here. See Beeson moving back? He thinks it's pass because that's all they do. As soon as he takes that step back, he gets set up for a block. He is blocked, and now look at Fowler with the momentum as he comes in. Beeson gets in on the tackle, but hey, that's 6 yards. And the reason for that is because Houston likes to pass the ball on almost every down. They get you sitting back on your heels, you have no momentum, and it's just simply easier to block you.
Doug Williams shaking his head in the sideline next to his favorite receiver, Al Williams. They're trying to figure out what's going wrong. They got to turn things around. They're down by 14 points early in the first. That was Kelly swinging it out to Sanders. Incomplete. There's a flag on the play. Might have been too much time. Motion on the Gamblers. To look at our officials. Verl Sorgen, the referee. Tom Myers, the umpire. Stuart Ross, Ted Kalana, William Fett, James. I'm going to have trouble with this one. Foglatance, I guess, and James Anderson.
He's
Can
my
you
cousin.
Say that name? Can
He's
you say
my cousin,
that name?
And I've never been able
Illegal
to
motion. Number 88, offense. Still second down.
That's Scott McGee. The penalty. Still second down. Ball on the 45-yard line for Houston.
This is the type of offense that really should be penalized a lot. They do a lot of crazy things, spread people out. You shouldn't be able to hear the snap count. Look how wide these guys go. But frankly, they do pretty well with those type of penalties.
Kelly, some pressure, gets it off to Johnson across the 40. Loses the football at the 35-yard line. Rod McMillan is there to chase him out. Another first down for Houston. in this run and shoot offense, you know, we've discussed it, nobody's really been able to stop it. Teams have tried to blitz, they've tried man-to-man, they've tried zone, and there really is no direct answer as to how to stop this offense. First down, Houston, 37-yard line. Kelly wants more. He's giving it to McNeil. McNeil struggling close to the first down at the 26-yard line. Kelly's got several receivers he feels comfortable to go to. McNeil, Johnson, Mosier, Sanders. They all can catch the football.
Let me talk a little bit more about offense and defense. Offensively, as I said, you try to create space so that you can get yardage. Now, this offense, because it's so far spread out and it spreads the defense out so much, just by lining up, you create space. You make a lot of room for those receivers to run around back there, and that is the object of offense. Once you complete the ball, you've got a lot of room to run with it. That's why Houston averages over 400 yards a game. They get a first down there. One of the things that you try to do against this team is cut down on the space. Get up on those receivers. Don't give them a lot of room to run down, and certainly don't let Jim Kelly run around back there. That's what Oklahoma's trying to accomplish here, and frankly, they're not doing a very good job of it, as you can see by the score.
Six first downs for Houston, all of them coming via the air. I guess the one way you have a shot at this thing is if you got four monsters on the defensive line who can outdo the other offensive line, you might have a shot to at least slow it down.
And band defense, you need great personnel to stop this offense.
The nose tackle out of the University of Miami. He knows Jim Kelly real well.
If you could have a big play in the first quarter of a game, which generally the plays, let's face it, with three quarters to go, you don't think of them as game-saving plays. That almost was a game-saving play. Down 14-0, Kelly gearing up to throw for another touchdown. Got to turn Houston around, send him in the other direction. Look at those stats. 7 for 956 yards. There are quarterbacks that don't do that an entire season.
I mean, 156 and two TDs. A lot of guys would call it quits and say, I'll take it for the day, right? We got 5:07 to go in the first quarter. Jack Pardee looking on. Likes what he sees. Johnson in motion. Kelly coming near side. Another sack. He is brought down out of nowhere, and there was nobody there. Curtis Anderson comes in. He is the number one sack man for Oklahoma. That gives him six. Six sacks on the year. And what was the problem there, Kevin, on the left side of the line?
Well, it's just a great hit, and Kelly is a big guy. He doesn't go down easy, but nobody gets out to block that man. And as he hits Kelly and drags him down, I think the official probably blew the whistle on contact, and he continued to drag him down. Kelly jumped up, threw the ball in his face. You never get the big guys mad at you, though. That's not a good idea.
Sets up a third and 27, Kim.
One of the things they were having problems with, Oklahoma started out trying to play 5-6 defensive backs, and that's good on coverage, but it doesn't help you with pressure. Tough to blitz with the big people. They've gone more to a four-man front, and they're sending some big people now.
Third and 27 for Houston is not out of the question. Kelly throwing, his man fell down at the 27-yard line. That is Johnson, number 22, who's shaking his head. He just happened to slip. Kelly had thrown the ball where he should have been, and Johnson just wasn't there.
Well, Oklahoma went the straight man to man. They put a little pressure on Johnson, made him make a move there, and he couldn't keep his footing. And they're playing hard at the corners now. The Outlaws are coming tough on those corners, making Kelly pull up and throw the ball. And that's what we saw 2 weeks ago against Michigan. They had some success with that.
And I would think this kind of a defensive performance here we've seen in this series might pump up the offense a little bit and help Oklahoma get things rolling a little bit. This is Dale Walters to punt for Houston. High punt. Not a real, it's going to be out. He's trying to get it inside the 10 there, was unsuccessful. So, it'll be first and 10 from the 20 for Oklahoma. The punt, 43 yards. We've got a 14-zip ball game at the Astrodome in Houston. Back with more football action in a moment. Outlaws got to get their act together. They've had three possessions here in the first quarter. First possession, no first down. They punted away. Second possession, Ernest Anderson fumbles. Third possession, Doug Williams throws an interception. They got to get the football down a football field. Steptoe in motion. The handoff. That is Anderson tries to spin away. He's not going anywhere. Cleveland Crosby makes the tackle for a loss of about 4 yards.
Defensively, as you see Williams go back, when he goes back as a quarterback, your assignment defensively is to wait until he passes the back, if it's a single back offense, as it was right there. He didn't pass him. The defense held up. He handed him the ball because it was a draw play, and the defense was there. Good play by Crosby. Really, it wasn't the tackle so much as the read. He read the draw.
Second, they're calling it 13 yards for the first. Big rush. Williams, look out. Caton brings him down at the 4-yard line for Pete Caton. That is sack number 10. He vaults into the lead on the Houston defensive club, and I'll tell you what, they're back down to the 4-yard line, and Williams has got to be shaking his head about now.
They like Doug Williams here. They say he's a leader. When you're blocking for a pass, the one thing you don't want the guy to do is push you straight back. Look at this. His number 77. He doesn't trick him. He just overpowers him. 73's got to stand up and take a stand and hold him off and give some room to Williams. Getting back to Williams, they like him here. They say he's a leader. Even under the worst conditions, he's patting guys on the butt and telling them they're doing a good job, and they just playing like him.
Nobody questions his character. Third down, very long. They're calling it 19. Williams swings it out. He was under pressure, trying to hit Sample, not even close. And Houston will take over again as Oklahoma is going to set to punt.
Williams threw that ball away intentionally. There was just no place to go. He knew it. He certainly doesn't want to throw it laterally inbounds when he's standing in his own end zone. And that's a good play by Doug Williams.
Dangerous position to be in. Case DeBruin, number 3. Into punt. Number 6 punter in the Western Conference. Average just over 39 yards. Ricky Sanders back to receive for Houston. A weak hit, hits at the 40, hits a Houston bounce out of bounds at the 42-yard line, and once again, Jim Kelly and company have excellent field position. They'll take over first and 10 at a 42-yard line. They lead 14-0 early in the first. Cheerleaders here in Houston have plenty to cheer about. Their club is up by 2 touchdowns. Chicago Cubs fans have plenty to cheer about, too. The Cubbies lead Houston 4-0. Cubs, of course, one of the surprise teams in the National League this year, making a run at the top spot in the NL East. First and 10, Houston, 42-yard line. Kelly, the draw play, Fowler, got some room across the 35, brought down at the 33-yard line by Terry Beeson.
Last week, Houston ran the ball once on first down when Kelly was in the game. Just once. Here they've got a 14-zip lead. They have good field position. And frankly, this is a good play for Houston always because everybody, as I said earlier, sits back on their heels. And Fowler's turned out to be the type of guy you want in the backfield when you grow up with.
The man who started most of the year, Sam Harrell, he's missed 4 games with an injury, expected back in about 2 weeks. In fact, he still leads the USFL in points scored with 94. But Fowler doing an excellent job in his place. Kelly, all kinds of time. He's got McNeil. They're going to give it to him? No. Had the ball and dropped it on contact with the turf. Barry Copeland on defense for Oklahoma just about had our 3rd touchdown pass of the day for Kelly. Let's see it again.
He's thrown to the backside of the rotation. Oklahoma came to his right, to the low side of the screen. He went behind it, and the hole was deep in the post pattern. The pass was good, and it was dropped. With all the gaudy statistics that Kelly has early in this game, he's had 3 dropped, and 2 of them could have been touchdowns.
3rd and 1. Kelly picks it up, dives across. I think he's got the first down. When things are going right, the ball bounces your way. And it did there for Houston and Jim Kelly. We'll see what happens as they jump off the pile. You can hear the crowd here saying, go, go, go. Apparently just short of the first down. Are they going to give it to him? No. Yes. 4th down.
They have a history of running a sneak. Kelly's a big, strong guy. 6'3", 215 pounds. Why bother to hand the ball off? What you look for here is the center. If he makes some penetration into the defense, Kelly will get to the first down. If he doesn't, because the linebacker stops him, he may have trouble going over the top.
Now the fans got what they wanted. Quick count. Kelly bowls ahead for the first down, as you can see, very easily. And you called it, Kevin.
When you watch something like that from home, if you think it's going to be a quarterback sneak, just watch the center and the two guards. If they get penetration, if they move forward, Kelly just follows him, gets right behind him, and drops on the ground for the first down. Here, take a look at it. Watch the center and the two guards. Guys come up to meet him, but see, they were able to take a step. Look at Khalil behind, or number 67. He's pushing Kelly from behind. 280 pounds behind you and 700 pounds in front of you. You ought to get a yard.
Passing yards. You can see there is no comparison. Down the 28-yard line. Vic Koning makes the tackle. Number 53 for Oklahoma. They're going to mark it at the 26-yard line. Gain of about 5 yards. We've got less than 40 seconds to go here in the first quarter. Gamblers lead at 14-0. It could be worse.
It could be worse. You're right. The Outlaws did a nice job on the deep coverage there, and the only thing Jim had was that underneath pass.
Mouse Davis, offensive coordinator for Houston, tells us that there's nobody on his Gamblers team that has improved more since the first day of practice till now than Jim Kelly. Fowler, not much, a couple. Curtis Anderson makes the stop.
Anytime you play a team, especially a team with a wide open offense like this, there's a period of adjustment. You're always a little tense, not understanding what they're going to do. Oklahoma's picking it up now.
Houston with a strong first quarter. They lead it 14-0. Back with the second quarter after that. Jack Pardee on the sidelines. Remember Jack, of course, linebacker with the Rams and the Redskins for a long time. Won a league title with the WFL back in 74. Coached with the Bears, with the NFC Coach of the Year back in 76. Coached the Skins for 3 years. He's been around.
Well, he had a problem in college with some injuries, and you can't put your shoulder down when it's hurt. The guy can run the ball, as you see, almost 300 yards this year. He wanted to go to Johnson, cutting across the middle on that play, but Oklahoma's picking up the offense a little bit, and they had it covered. Of course, Kelly, the reason he's so valuable is that he's able to do other things, and one of those other things is run for first down.
Kelly going for his 8th 300-yard passing game of the year. Professional football history. That's only been done one at a time. That's by Dan Fouts. That is Fowler crashing across. He's down to about the 12-yard line. These are the statistics for the first quarter. Not too hard to tell who's dominating here. Look at the 19 total yards for Oklahoma. They only had 8 offensive plays. And of course, the big stat as well is the 2 turnovers.
We're talking about space offensively. One of the enemies of the Houston offense is getting close to the goal line. They like to run up and down the field with 40 or 50 yards. We have an injury, as you can see. It looks like it's Darryl Goodloe, linebacker. One of the things they need is room, space, for the Houston offense to operate. When they get down near the goal line, they do go to the run more often because it's difficult for these 4 or 5 receivers that get into the secondary to find enough room so they don't run into each other. So Houston's offense really is predicated on striking from outside of 30 yards. When they get inside, they got to tough it out and grind out the yardage, and it makes defense a lot easier. Goal line defense a lot easier to play than regular defense because you only have a few yards to cover.
You know, Houston's got a record of 7 wins and 5 losses, but if you look back at some of the games that they've played, it could be a much better record. They've lost 4 games by 3 points, and 3 of those were in overtime. So I think the Houston record is 7-5, although that's good, might be a little deceptive. It could be much better. Let's now go to ABC Sports Control. Jim Lampley, there's a lot of action around the USFL today. Let's check in with Jim and see what's happening. We'll get back here and see if Houston doesn't score. Just a minute. keep it here. See what Kelly can do. Johnson, or it's McNeil with the touchdown. I'm glad we didn't go away. Perfectly led pass from Kelly to McNeil in the corner of the end zone. Good for 13 yards, Kelly's third touchdown pass of the day.
Well, Kelly's looking right at him, see, and Copeland, what he does is he lets him run away from him. They were together going down the field, but as they get close to the end zone there, McNeil just moved away from him, and Jim is relaxing now after his third touchdown pass here early in the second quarter.
I think that Jim's got to be feeling real relaxed right now.
Yeah.
Threw five touchdown passes last week. He's got three. We've got 13:31 to go in the first half. Fritz converts. Got ourselves a 21-0 ball game. Houston is playing some football today. And Kelly, we've seen him a couple of times. And of course, all season long, he's been strong. But I don't think he's been any stronger than this all year long. Let's check in on the field now with our sideline reporter, Jerry Park. Jerry, what's happening?
Jim, three touchdown passes, and you only played about 17 minutes of the ballgame. Everything's going right for you.
Yeah, pretty well. We remembered the game last time when we played them, and I think everybody's psyched. Our defense coming through, and offensive line's doing a great job.
The offensive line, you've had plenty of time, all except just a couple of problems.
Yeah, they blitzed a couple times. The receivers didn't pick it up. They weren't ready for it, but overall, we're ready. I'd like to say hi to my mom and dad. I love you all.
Jim Kelly on the sideline so far with three touchdown passes, adding to his USFL record. Corey?
That's great. Jim Kelly excited. You know, last week he went home. He says hi to his mom and dad. He went home to Pittsburgh last week when the Gamblers played the Maulers. He's from a suburban area of Pittsburgh and had an incredible game, as you mentioned. Five touchdowns last week. Nearly 400 yards in the air and had a nice homecoming. And he's putting it up in the air again today and doing more of the same.
He may make that one look bad this week, the way he's going.
A bit of a workout today in the first half. Line drive kick. It is caught there. That is Lonnie Harris. Tries to work his way up the sidelines. He gets by a man across midfield. Cuts back, and I think they're going to say he stepped out of bounds. Hey, that kid is explosive over at the 40, I think the 46-yard line. Lonnie is dangerous. 35 yards on that return.
It's the second time he stepped out of bounds. Let's take a look at this. His responsibility is simply to find an opening. You do have plays on kickoff returns, but the kickoff return man is the guy who finds the opening. Doesn't matter where it is. And Harris here, right here, is caught just there. His left leg drags out of bounds. Aside from that, he might have cut across and gone all the way. Corey, it's procedure, left side of that Oklahoma line jumped. And when you look at this, what's happening here, they haven't done anything. I don't think there's any facet of the game that Oklahoma has executed so far. The defensive secondary's been beaten. The draw play has beaten the defensive line. Offensively, they're not able to run. They're not able to throw, and they've had a poor punt. And aside from the special teams and Lonnie Harris.
Offense, penalty decline, second down.
A performance like this will make you mad, and if it doesn't make you mad by the half, the coach will make you mad when you get in there at halftime.
I think by this time, you got to think about a morale and attitude problem maybe developing. I mean, how tough is it? You've played football a lot of times. When you lose and you get blown out four times, and now you're down 21-0 in the first half of your fifth game.
Teams with character get mad and play harder. Teams that are not going to be good, they lay down.
Steptoe in motion. Ernest Anderson, the backfield. Going to be called grounding. No, the Houston fans would like that. Williams just gets it off. A good rush out there from Caton and Fitzpatrick. Fitzpatrick, by the way, played some football.
Tell you something about Doug Williams. Excuse me, Corey. Tell you something about Doug Williams. Now, he could have turned his back here and gone down. Now, look what he did. He knows he's going to get dumped on his back, and that hurts. But that's a grounding, by the way, but they didn't call it. But he stood up there and saved the down or saved some yardage there and threw it up, knowing that the guy was going to plant him. And that takes a lot of guts to do that.
Williams throwing, incomplete pass at the 37-yard line of Houston. That ball intended for Wheeler, the tight end, and Wheeler, his club's number one receiver. I think it's the first ball that Williams thrown towards him today.
It's a great throw. It was right in Wheeler's hands, and he dropped it. And although he is the leading receiver, we talked with some people yesterday, and he has dropped some passes this year.
It's Walter Poole on the sideline for Houston.
I don't know that I'd be smiling if I had that thing on my leg.
Well, it makes it a little easier, I'm sure. Spiraling punt. That is McNeil way back at his 5-yard line. Drops the football, picks it up, squirms his way up to near the 10-yard line. Gerald had the dropsies there. 47-yard punt, a return of 3 yards. Houston once again on offense. They lead by 3 touchdowns here at the Dome. 21. Zip. Scott McGee and Clarence Verdan in the ball game as receivers. Jim Kelly once again goes up top, hits his man across the 20. That is McGee, Scott McGee. See, all these receivers, you go down, they got 4, 5, 6 guys who all have good numbers. McGee, 25 receptions, 381 yards and 2 touchdowns. Went to Eastern Illinois. He was Division II All-American. But, I mean, they got receivers and receivers and receivers. Of course, this offense can pump up anybody's stats, I guess, Kevin.
The guy's thrown for 31 touchdowns. That means 31.
Drop play, Fowler powering down close to the 30-yard line. It's 21-0 Houston here. Let's check in with Jim Lampley at ABC Sports Control, see what's happening across the USFL.
Out in the Los Angeles Coliseum, the Michigan Panthers have taken the lead over the LA Express. Ken Lacy, a non-contributor in recent weeks, going to the NFL's Chiefs soon, scored that touchdown from 1 yard out to give Michigan a 7-3 lead over LA. Let's go back to Corey McFerrin in the Astrodome.
So Michigan trying to keep pace with Houston. They're tied for the lead in the Central Division of the Western Conference. Kelly rifles one far side, overthrows his man. It was Scott McGee diving for the football.
One of the things that's so frustrating when you play Houston and play against that man is that they confuse you defensively. And defensively, you like to sit in the locker room and really get gunned up and mad, and you want to go out and hit somebody, and you can't catch these guys. You run around trying to hit them, and you've got nobody to hit. And then next thing you know, you turn around, it's 21-0, and you hang your head and you come out. It really, really gets tough. And now's when you find out about the character of a team. You can get beat, and you get beat badly, but character is something that you carry week to week, and you improve if you have it.
3rd and 4. To the 37-yard line.
Let's take a look at this. I'm going to show you why these underneath patterns work. And what Kelly's got him thinking is deep. He's got this defense for the Outlaws going all the way back, and then they have people cutting underneath. Remember, they have 4 quick receivers. There's your 4 deep defensive backs here. Now, he sends people deep, drives them back. Look at them, 40, 50-yard line. Remember, the ball's inside the 35 at this point. They're in. You've got 1, 2, 3, 4 defensive backs over midfield, and the play went to the 42-yard line. That's one of the reasons the offense works.
We've got 10:35 to go in the first half. 1st and 10 for Houston, 37-yard line. Fowler across the 40-yard line, tripped up there by Terry Beeson and Bob Nelson. Hey, how about it, Kevin? We've got 10:20 to go here in the first half. 3 touchdown passes, 202 yards via the air for Mr. Kelly.
Kelly's an outstanding player. On that play, you wonder about the man in motion and why the man in motion is so important. What he does, he dictates what the defense does. He'll make that defense show what defense they're in. On that particular play, they went to trips, and they put the man in motion. He was the third man, caused everybody to go one side of the field, and Kelly went to the draw play.
There's a break in the action here at the Astrodome. Back with the remainder of the first half in just a moment. You want to stick around at halftime today. Howard Cosell will talk with Jim Palmer Jim, of course, a certain Hall of Famer, 19 years with the Baltimore Orioles, given his release earlier this week. We'll hear it from Jim, his plans, his feelings about leaving the Orioles. Howard Cosell and Jim Palmer at halftime. Jim Kelly, look out, he is taken down, 28-yard line. Dewey McClain takes off, the third sack of the day for Oklahoma. And Kelly grabbing his elbow a little bit there.
Now you wonder where a sack comes from. It's the backside here. Now the guard is supposed to meet this guy. Come out, one of the linemen, see him as he tries to get back. Kid, number 61, he's way, way late. And number 52, the linebacker, just nobody guarding him. The backside responsibility is the uncovered lineman. As you see, the man who made the sack coming off the field.
Dewey McClain, interesting guy, went to East Central State in Oklahoma, 6'3", 230 pounds, spent 6 years with the Atlanta Falcons, and he was so happy after he was with Oakland last year, traded to Memphis to come back to Oklahoma and play some football, said all he wanted to do was get back to good old dusty Oklahoma. Fowler, off the pass from Kelly, 45, across midfield to the 48-yard line. Houston is moving, and that screenplay has been unstoppable today.
Well, they screened away from the motion or away from the strength of the offense. Take a look at the defensive backs on this play and where they all go and where Kelly throws the ball. As you look, the defensive backs, see 1, 2, 3, 4 white shirts on the top side of the screen? Well, the play came to the bottom of the screen. That's what Houston likes to do. Only on this particular play, there was a flag thrown.
Check it out, obviously against Houston. Listen in.
Ineligible receiver, downfield, number 72, offense, loss of down, fourth down.
Now, Kevin, that's a problem that they have had from time to time this year.
Well, screenplay is a timing play. You have to release after he catches the ball. If the lineman releases before they catch the ball, he's downfield. Remember, it's a pass, and you're not allowed to go past the line of scrimmage.
So Houston, instead of being across midfield, is going to punt it away. Dale Walters is here. And take a look at this angle and imagine yourself with Lonnie Harris or Lonnie Turner. See if you can catch this football. Here it comes. I got it. That is Harris. Doesn't get too far. There are flags on the play.
A lot of times on a flag, guy releases maybe a little early. They changed that rule about 10 years ago. It's a procedure penalty on Houston. Now, that's two penalties in a row. The quickest way to stop momentum when you're winning 21-0 is start getting penalties. Give breaks to the
illegal formation. Offense. Penalty decline. First down.
Penalty is declined, as you heard. So Oklahoma will take over at the 39-yard line and see if they can't get some offense generated. They trail right now by 3 touchdowns with 9:15 to go in the first half. There's a second quarter score. The Panthers lead the Express 7-3. Panthers, of course, the 1983 USFL champions. Battling with Houston to stay on top of the Central Division. Williams going deep for Steptoe. And Steptoe just about ahead of the 10-yard line. That was Mike Mitchell, stride for stride with Steptoe on the far sideline.
Oklahoma's got to get some points on the board, and I guess they figure the quickest way to do it is to crank up that iron arm of Doug Williams. There's no question, nobody's ever doubted the fact that Doug can throw the ball 50 yards. On that play, Steptoe was 30 yards short of where the ball actually landed when Doug let go of it, and he ran under it. Good defense by Houston.
60 yards in the air, that pass. 14-7, San Antonio leads Washington. And the Breakers lead Tampa Bay by a score of 10-7. That ball game in the second quarter. Williams and Steptoe, your wide receivers, top of the screen. Steptoe in motion. The give is to Anderson. He's got some running room. Breaks one tackle, 45-yard line, pushes up to the 49, and that is the kind of running that Ernest showed during his career at Oklahoma State. That was an impressive run.
That'll only show up, we have a man down there, and that'll only show up as 10 yards on the play sheet, but what Anderson did there on the sideline, in front of the Houston bench, making that hit, taking that hit, and going for another 5 yards may ignite this team a little bit. They need plays like that.
That's Mike Catalan, Oklahoma, center, 6'3", 255.
Some excellent blocking on this play, really terrific blocking as you take a look at Fitzpatrick there. He's a little bit short. See how he screened away from the play? And he just couldn't see what was going on. The running back, Anderson, kind of got by. The center's down. See as he gets...
Ooh.
See, look at Catalan as he got... Somebody lays on the back of his leg there, and he gets bent over. That generally is an ankle or a knee injury. They're looking at his ankle.
Kevin, Ernest Anderson, a bit of a homecoming, as we mentioned earlier. Jerry Parks talked to him on the field from nearby Orange, Texas. He had quite a year in 1982 at Oklahoma State. In fact, the fifth best rushing season in the history of the NCAA, 1,877 yards. Big Eight record. He's a good player, and of course the Outlaws hoping that he can produce for them. As you see his stats today, 4 for 14. He rushed only 3 times last week in his debut in the USFL, 3 for 10.
Offensively, you have to believe you can do something. You have to establish some part of the game, and that's Oklahoma's problem here. They have to get either the run or the pass going.
Doug Williams' last 5 passing attempts, incomplete. Bullet, intended for Turner, almost brings it down, goes way up in the air, unable to control it at the 35-yard line. Boy, that was a rifle.
It was a rifle and it was high, and that's the problem. Receivers don't like to see the ball high because this is what happens. Once you leave your feet, you have no momentum, no strength under you, and just about anything can happen. Let's take a look at Williams here. Now, Williams is a big guy, and he holds the ball high. Watch him get the ball up when he throws it. A lot of times that can sail, and that is a gun. That's slow motion, folks. He's almost got it, and then Houston closes on him. It would have been a great catch, and a tough, tough thing for a receiver. They hate to go off their feet, and only the good ones will jump. Only the good ones.
And Turner obviously in some pain.
Lonnie Turner's wanted to break into the receiving core. He's been a kick returner, and he's felt that he could play as a receiver.
Out of Cal Poly Pomona. One thing to remember, as you see the total yardage differential there, is that last time the two teams met in late March in Tulsa, Houston had a 15-point lead in the fourth quarter. Oklahoma storms back to tie it in the final seconds. They go on to win it in OT.
I know.
And I think we should remember that Houston can strike. They can strike quickly. And you better believe Houston remembers that. Jay Biquette, by the way, in to replace the injured Catalan. And Turner is still down the football field.
You know, we talked about jumping, and one of the things that does, when you're running along the ground, you're used to being on the ground, you can protect yourself, and you know how to protect yourself. Turner's just a little bit of a guy. When you jump, you don't know where you're going to land, and when
right.
you go down, a lot of times you get hurt.
8:34 to go, first half, 21-0, Houston in command. Jim Kelly warming up in the sidelines, and he is loose about now, you better believe it. 5 touchdown passes last week. He already has 3 today. 8:34 to go in the first half, and he may be en route to breaking that record he established last week. The golf cart on the field, about the 37-yard line. Lonnie Turner, the flanker out of Cal Poly Pomona, 5'9", 164, being carted off, and we certainly hope that injury is not serious. Jim Kelly got to be feeling real comfortable about now with what's transpired here, at least in the first 20 minutes of this ballgame.
Turner, as you see him, that golf cart going across the field, he got up and he walked into the golf cart, so it's not his legs. It was something to do with his rib cage or his shoulder. And he was able to stand up, so we do hope he feels better.
We will see Otha Hill, number 81, near side of the screen in there to replace Lonnie Turner. Hasn't played all that much this year. There he is coming after us. Williams going long for Steptoe, almost has it at the 5-yard line. Steptoe one stride away from touchdown. Again, that was a monstrous throw.
Doug Williams has always had a reputation as a bomber, but you can't blame Williams. He's down 21 to nothing. And what else are you going to do? He throws it here, and Steptoe almost runs underneath it. Look at the defense. The black shirts trailing him. Just about another foot.
It's third and 10. Seven straight incompletions for Williams. Williams in college at Grambling established the NCAA record for 93 touchdown tosses in his career. Got to get a completion here. Escapes from Crosby, still on his feet, dumps it off across the way. That is Wheeler at the 30, down the 25-yard line. A good exhibition of scrambling by Williams, Wheeler's first catch of the day.
Well, you see the way this play develops. Now, this was an illegal play. It was an attempt to pick somebody by Wheeler, and you're not supposed to get rewarded for bad things. He's going to miss the pick. Watch him. 88, bottom of your screen. Play goes off. Now, look, as he tries to pick off the linebacker, that's illegal. They're trying to throw into the flat. Williams can't get it. So here's Wheeler releasing. Takes off down the field, and blown plays, don't you know it, always turn it around. Williams, with the good eyes, finds him, and that's the biggest play of the day for the Outlaws. I guess that's why they call them Outlaws.
First down.
They may put that one in, Corey. They called the blown pick play.
Great isolation there.
Yeah, that was. Terrific shot.
25-yard line for Oklahoma. They'd like to go into the end zone soon. Ernest Anderson doesn't find any room. Takes off right side across the 25. Jumps up to the 23. And that's the kind of running you see Anderson do in college, where he will see he doesn't have any room to go anywhere and takes off a different direction. That's a sign of a good back.
It's going to get his defense pumped up doing things like that. There's special people do those things.
Let's go down the sidelines now, and our man on the field, Jerry Parks. Jerry.
Well, as you saw just a few moments ago, they took Lonnie Williams into the dressing room with the Oklahoma Outlaws. He has some bruised ribs on the left side. They're taking him for x-rays at this point. We know he's hurt. We just don't know how bad, but we should know as soon as the x-rays are complete, Corey.
Okay. Hopefully it's not bad for Lonnie Turner. Williams. Got a man at the 20, and boy, is he crushed. That is Ragsdale. And the man who hit him there is Tommy Myers, the veteran. He banged up a little bit. He says, I'm going to the bench for a minute. I got to get the cobwebs out. Ooh. You see the pain there.
11-year veteran. Those guys are fragile. You know, they played for 11 years. And that was a great pass by Williams. He just turned around and gunned that thing out there to Ragsdale. The offense getting cranked up a little bit here for Oklahoma.
I'm going to tell Tommy what you said about him after the game. Yard line, third and five. Oklahoma's got a shot at putting some points on the board. 6:39 to go. They trail 21-0. Timeout. Doug Williams realizes it's a big play, the biggest play they've had so far in the first half. He wants to make sure he does it right, gets the first down, makes sure Oklahoma goes in for six. They trail by three touchdowns. Back to four in a moment. I want to remind you at halftime to stay with us, Howard Cosell talking with Jim Palmer, who of course is known for all kinds of things like fashion underwear, things of that nature, also pitching a baseball, which he did for 19 years. Jim Palmer with Howard Cosell at halftime right here at ABC. Big third down at five. That is Anderson. He has got the first down and then some. Inside the 10, fumbles the football. Who's got it? Houston say they have the football. Jack Pardee says yes. See what the referee says.
Well, I don't know that was a fumble. I think he was down. Yeah, I think they're calling him down.
All right.
This is a great call. Ernest Anderson is the guy. They are really looking for this guy to make some offense. They need it. It's the biggest down of the game for Oklahoma, and they go to their new acquisition at Oklahoma State. Whoa, he wasn't down.
And the reaction you're hearing is from the fans because they just saw it on the big screen here at the Astrodome.
That's a
big
play.
It's a bad call.
Oh, big play for Oklahoma and a bigger play for Ernest and his confidence. If he'd got called on that one, it could have been tough.
Oklahoma's deepest penetration prior to this drive was the Houston 41. yard line. Anderson hit high in the backfield. 17 yard line. Kiki Diallo is there. That was Lazarus, not Anderson.
Last week, Oklahoma had first and goal twice. This is not exactly first and goal, but they were close, and they passed both times. This may be the reason. Again, close to the goal line, defenses change, and the offensive blocking assignments change, and there are some things you just can't do. And evidently, one of them is run that play.
Kiki Diallo. Linebackers love to make a clean hit like that in the backfield. There's some movement on the line. There are flags everywhere. Wait and see who went first.
False start. Number 77, offense.
Jim Lamb, the right tackle, moves. Watch him on the right side.
This type of thing is devastating. You can see him there as he jumps. And you saw the defensive player was keying Lamb's movement. As soon as he went, so did the defensive player.
Boy, not the place in the field where you want a penalty like that. Second and 17.
Williams had his man deep. That ball thrown a little deeper instead of wider, and it would have been a touchdown.
Williams to Williams. It has been a successful combination this year so far. It's third and goal, 17-yard line. Bad news, Astros fans. Houston trailing the Cubbies, 7-1. Williams to the turf. So Oklahoma, with an opportunity to put six on the board, not going to be able to do it. They're going to go for three as they trail 21-0. Efren Herrera will come in. Efren, 12 of 20 so far this year. This will be a 34-yard kick. He is 4 of 6 between 30 and 39 yards so far this year. It is up. And it is good. Oklahoma is on the board. That is field goal number 13 for Herrera. And they're 3 points closer. 21-3. Houston still in command. Efren Herrera, who won three games in the final minutes against Houston. The first time against Michigan and Chicago. Quite a hero, and says, I wish the game came down to me every time. That's the right attitude, huh? 5:01 to go here in the first half. 21-3, the Gamblers firmly in control. And I think Oklahoma's got to be a little discouraged. They weren't able to punch that thing across. They had some good plays. They had some momentum. The drive looked good. And when they got down to where it counted, they couldn't make the plays.
Well, you have to walk before you can crawl. You have to crawl before you can walk.
Maybe you walk before you crawl. But
maybe that's why I'm up here and not down there. I was walking before I crawled. Anyway, they moved the ball a little bit. They had no success early in the half. And remember, the great thing about falling behind so badly in the first quarter is you have three quarters to catch up. So
that's an optimist.
Yeah,
right
about
there,
that?
Let me tell you.
I did a lot of falling behind early. So this really, nothing's out of it here. The Outlaws could win this game.
Around the USFL, Express kicked the field goal. They trail Michigan 7-6. New Orleans out front, Tampa Bay 14-10. That's a second quarter score. Herrera will kick it off. 3-yard line. That is Corville coming across the field. 15, nice move. 20, 25. That's outside. Across the 35. Great run by Corville to the 39-yard line.
nice return. Watch when he gets to the hash mark and starts to cut across the field. You should see some people go down. Look at it. You see the angles he's giving his people? That whole mess there on the left of the screen. And now it's just up to Corville as he turns it up the field. He makes a real good move here. Look at Herrera. Oh, no. He says, oh, goodness. That's bad. And back goes Corville, and he turns back into the pursuit, and they get him. A great, great kick return.
I think Efren had no shot there, basically, Kev. 39-yard line for Houston. Kelly going right side to Mosier. Incomplete. Let him a little bit too much at about the 32-yard line. Herb Williams out there defending against Mosier, number 85, getting up a little bit slowly.
Kelly is walking back. And he's so confident they're not going to get to him. He's walking back when he takes the snap, and he's just kind of, he's out for a Sunday stroll. These guys have got to force Kelly. I mean, you can't let this guy run around back there. He's got a rifle arm. He's very accurate. And he's got receivers that'll catch the ball. They have to force from the corners. Remember early in the game when they forced from the corners and they started to have some success?
Right.
They got to play hard corners against this team.
We've got 4:24 to go here in the first half. That's Johnson, number 22, top of your screen. A little bit of pursuit there. Kelly, plenty of room. He's going to run. He's got the first down, out of bounds, across midfield at the 48-yard line of Oklahoma. Herb Williams there to force him out. And the fans love to see a quarterback that is not afraid to run the football.
When you rush the quarterback, you don't cross his face. You have to stay on the outside shoulder. Now, they get pressure here. As Kelly looks, see how slow he's just coming back in and out. Look, he sees the pursuit, but that man's coming from the outside. You have to stay on the outside shoulder and force him back into the middle of the formation. And now Jim says, well, he says, I think I'll take off for the end zone.
Jim Kelly. What a year he is having. It's a big screen monitor on top of your picture there. About the 40 near sideline, apparently was able to recover the football at about the 44.
One of the things I've noticed about this team is that their receivers don't fumble the ball. We've watched them for two games now, Corey, and these guys are really pretty short-handed. They're just little guys, and they get hit a lot. But see there, as he rips the arm down, he's supposed to strip these guys, get into the stripping stage here, 21-3. You should be going for the ball, and Verdan drops it.
Dewey McClain there to make the stop. Miles Davis is putting in some of the secondary receivers, guys like Clarence Verdan out of Southwest Louisiana. Scott McGee in the ballgame. Kelly, complete pass at the 35-yard line to Ricky Sanders. Good for the first down by a couple of yards, and Houston continues to move.
Outlaws did come up with a hard corner on that play. They forced the blocker in the backfield. They made Kelly put up, but Sanders reading, and Kelly reading. Sanders knew his quarterback was getting a little pressure. He hooked up, and Kelly was able to complete that thing. These guys, it's almost like it's one mind out there. You know, Mouse has got them all thinking the same way, and everything that happens, everybody reacts and understands what each guy's doing, and it works. Obviously, we're watching it work.
First down, Houston. Draw play, Fowler cuts outside. Powers inside the 30-yard line. Koning and Middleton there to stop Mr. Fowler. 2:20 to go here in the first half. And Houston's going to try to get in for six more before this half is out.
Well, Woody Widenhofer is the man who is responsible, given the credit for the Pittsburgh Steel Curtain defense. And right about now, these guys better start acting like it, because this is a big series. You don't want to go down 28-3 at halftime.
You do not. Right now, there's a break in the action. The two-minute warning. Houston in command here at the Astrodome. Now, a word from the USFL.
There's an old saying, the best defense is a good offense. Like you got the 10-yard button hook, okay? Ready? Hi, I'm Steve Young of the USFL's LA Express, and I'm a believer.
Hey! Young in trouble, break free. He's open along the right side. Touchdown!
Also on the offensive is the March of Dimes. and I'm asking for your support of its efforts to prevent birth defects. Premature birth is a major cause of infant illness and death.
Go, go!
With funding from the Colonel Sanders Memorial Endowment, the March of Dimes supports an offensive team that's out to change that.
Oh, yeah!
Let me just see your last training.
These doctors and nurses work with pregnant women to identify early and to treat those at risk of having a premature baby and to help them deliver a normal, healthy child. The March of Dimes is winning against birth defects, thanks in part to the support of the Colonel Sanders Memorial Endowment and to your continued support of the March of Dimes.
This message furnished by the United States Football League.
The preceding message brought to you by the United States Football League. There is Jack Pardee. Interesting last night, Kevin, I thought, talking to Miles Davis, to get a feel for how Pardee and Davis work together. Pardee is strictly defensive-oriented, while Davis is in total control of the offense, and Pardee really, except for on fourth-down situations, do you go for it, do you punt, what do you do, has really nothing to say about what happens offensively.
Jack, always a traditionalist. You know, he came from the NFL when it was a very kind of a traditional offensive thing. He's got to make him pull his hair out when he wants his mouth to drop.
Nothing is stopped immediately at the line.
Dewey McClain offsides on that.
Well, he did.
He did it last play. He's anticipating the snap count. He's trying to get to Kelly before Kelly can throw the ball or get that drawback. On that play, McClain just jumped just a little bit. You'll see him on the left side. Excuse me, on the right side. Yeah, I can't see it in that shot, but he came from the outside. Did it two plays in a row. That time he got caught.
First down for Houston.
See, that's bad. That's bad. That's the type of thing when you're going bad, you're having trouble with an offense, you just can't help them. These guys don't need any help at all. They'll move it down the field on their own, thank you.
But they'll take it.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Kelly already three touchdown passes. Todd Fowler, 44 yards on the ground. He's going after his third consecutive 100-yard rushing performance. Kelly is thrown to the ground. That is Curtis Anderson. Kelly back to the 34-yard line. That is sack number four on the day against Kelly.
Big play there by Anderson, and Kelly set up very quickly on that play. Took the snap. He was looking to hit the quick pass, and Anderson just came hard and made the play. It's a big, big play for the Outlaws. Thing in the back of everybody's mind in this game is that Oklahoma scored 15 points late in the game to win against Houston last time, and now Houston and the Outlaws both remember that.
Second and 17. Kelly, watch it now, gets away, and then again it's Anderson. Another sack.
Seven men came on that play. Seven men on Kelly. And when they've done that type of thing, they've had success. They sent everybody, went man-to-man with four backs in the defensive backfield. They're making things happen. You can't sit back on defense. You have to make things happen. You have to make it go your way.
Five sacks. Houston's lost 39 yards on those five sacks. And the key there is if Kelly does get the ball off in a hurry as the blitz is on, they got a big gainer most times.
You know, even if Houston gets a field goal here, Oklahoma's showing very strong now here late in the second quarter. They have something to build on, something to talk about in the locker room. Extremely important psychologically.
Penalties everywhere, flags everywhere. Too much time just to not get it off fast enough. So another penalty here against Houston.
Well, you see what it does, you see. You see when you start to play well defensively, they go back in the huddle and they start talking about it. Well, what happened? What'd you do? Why did the guy sack me? That's two in a row. In the meantime, you're not calling the play. By the time you call the play, get up to the line of scrimmage, too much time has elapsed. So, you know, you can control the game a little bit defensively if you just come and force things. Coach once told me, he said, I don't care if you make a mistake. Just make a mistake going full speed.
Yeah.
I think that's important, and it could be applied to the Outlaws here.
Curtis Anderson having one heck of a day. He came in as the sack leader with five. He now has eight. First choice for Oklahoma in the veteran allocation draft. Third down play in 26. Kelly all kinds of time. Pumps it once. He's running. Is he going to go down? No. On his feet. Gets away. Down to the 32-yard line before he's run out by Herb Ewing. job to get back as far as he did, but nowhere close to the first down.
This is great running. This guy ought to be a halfback. Watch this. He has time. The defense rolled with him. The defense started to move in front of him so they could get in his passing lane. And finally, when they get penetration, their lanes break down. See, Kelly goes in and he comes out, and now he's going to take off downfield. This is just great athletic ability. 5 for 31. He's got more yards on the ground than anybody in the backfield for Oklahoma, including the running backs, but way short of the first down.
All right. Sets up a 4th and 18.
Houston's
calling a timeout. The ball's on a 32-yard line. Will they kick it? Kelly's saying,
well, you know, sometimes you think Houston goes backwards just to give themselves room to throw the ball. This is not, you know, they're on the 40-yard line. This is routine for them.
No, that's exactly right. I mean, we laugh at it, but it's really true. I mean, it's the philosophy is so much different.
Excuse me, it's true that they can put the offense... Their offense, their open field offense, works better outside the 30-yard line. So really the question here is, I don't think whether to kick a field goal. I don't know that they can kick a field goal from out here, but what type of play to run and try and get a touchdown. 21-3, they're not in any danger of losing the lead, so I think you'll probably see some kind of formation. I think so, too.
And football. Also, you know, when you look at Tony Fritsch, doesn't have the long-distance leg. He's only had one this year between 40 and 49. And although he does have the highest percentage of any field goal kicker in the league, a 9 of 11.
Well, that was last week. That was a 42-yard field goal last week. This one would be a 49-yard field goal if they attempted it right here. I bet Tony take a running start from the 50. He might get it up there.
It does look like the assistant to Miles Davis, the offensive coordinator. So. By the way, the 5 sacks today by Oklahoma ties a team record on the year, so something to be happy about. 4th and 18, 32-yard line. Kelly dumps it off. It's the screen play to Fowler. Fowler across the 25, down to about the 22. He is still about 7 yards short of the first down.
I needed to get out of bounds on that play if he did get a first down, but I guess he did the smart thing, really, when you think about it, because having to turn the ball over possession-wise, he stayed in bounds and made Oklahoma, if they want a timeout, they'll have to call it. A little slip here. It's a slip screen as he goes right past the blocker. The blocker knew what was going to happen,
yep.
And he trying to turn around, he fell down, the defensive player. So you got to be impressed by Fowler. He never goes backwards. Boy, the guy puts his shoulder down, and he'll get 3-4 tough yards every time.
Best blocker they have out of the backfield by far. He's a tough one. 27 seconds to go. I would expect we'll see Doug throw the 65 to 70 yard bomb to Al Williams, who is screaming on the left sideline. Exactly what's happening. Looks pretty good from here. It's caught. Intercepted. But out of bounds. Just barely. Reggie Bonner on the far side. Wanted to catch that ball.
I think we might see 3 more of those. Question here is, can Doug Williams throw the ball 85 yards? And we're going to find out here. He just loads up and sends it. He throws it plenty far, but hey, that's what they have deep safeties for. As you can see right there in the middle of your screen, he's back there already.
Like a center fielder. We're down to 20 seconds now. We'll probably see that same thing again. Steptoe near side. Williams going down, and I'm afraid I'm a little puzzled by that. I mean, why not chuck it upstairs? That's going to do it for the first half as the clock ticks down. 4 seconds, 3 seconds, 2, 1. And that is it for the first half. The fans here in Houston are happy. Their ball club firmly in command. 21-3, the score here at halftime. The Gamblers going for their 8th victory on the year. We'll be back after this message and a word from our local stations.
Jim Lampley again in New York. We welcome those of you who are at halftime of Houston and Oklahoma and what might be called for the moment the Jim Kelly Show. Here's what's going on out in Los Angeles, where the Michigan Panthers are trying to get back on the right track, but trailing at halftime against the Los Angeles Express. The score in the ballgame, 14-10. It started early for L.A. They got a Tony Zendejas field goal for a 3-0 lead, but then Ken Lacy capped an 82-yard drive for Michigan in the second quarter, and that gave the Panthers a 7-3 lead. Then after another Zendejas field goal, an interception by Tyrone Justin set up this 28-yard Young to Freddie Scott touchdown pass. Young ran in the conversion for 2 points, and later Novo Bojovic kicked the field goal for Michigan to narrow LA's lead to 14-10. Bobby Hebert in that game, again plagued by the interception. He's thrown three of them in the first half, and they have set up all of Los Angeles's points. New Orleans 8-4 against Tampa Bay 9-3, an action-filled game in the first half in Tampa Bay. Burt Reynolds and friends there on what might be called Celebrity Day, and both teams chasing Birmingham in the Southern Division. Early, John Reeves hit Eric Trevelyan from 3 yards out to make it 7-0 Tampa Bay after a drive in which the Bandits went largely without a huddle. Steve Spurrier doing a good job of coaching again. Then John Walton threw this pass to Frank Lockett, got down just in bounds to set up a 1-yard touchdown run by Marcus Dupree. Dupree had 11 carries for 58 yards in the half, and that touchdown tied the ball game at 7-7 in the first quarter. After a Tim Mazzetti field goal made it 10-7 New Orleans, watch this strange play. Reeves throwing for Trevelyan. Trevelyan bats the ball up in the air into the hands of Spencer Jackson, who goes down the sidelines and got it to the 2-yard line. That set up a 2-yard touchdown by Gary Anderson, who will skirt the right side and outrun the defender, and that made it 14-10 Tampa Bay. But then Walton again found Frank Lockett inside a minute to go in the first half to set up another 1-yard Marcus Dupree touchdown. And at halftime, New Orleans has gone back on top in the ballgame, 17-14. If you're a fan of omens, we would point out New Orleans has played 7 times on Sunday afternoon in this USFL season, and they have yet to lose. They are 1-4 playing on the other days of the week. San Antonio is at Washington at halftime in that ballgame. The Gunslingers have a 17-7 lead. They have gotten 2 touchdown passes from Rick Neuheisel in the ballgame. Now, we're going back to the Astrodome, Corey McFerrin and Kevin Kiley. Let's return you there right now.
We're back at the Astrodome. Corey McFerrin, Kevin Kiley, and Jerry Potts, 21-3. You see our score. Houston going after their 8th victory in 13 attempts. Doug Williams got to have a better second half than he performed in the first half. That is for sure, as Oklahoma, ineffective offensively, got to come up with some offense, got to do some things. You know, one thing, though, Kevin, we should recognize is the fact that, to look at the first half stats there, where total yardage is the most obvious. 271-70, Houston way in front, more than 200 yards. 2 turnovers for Oklahoma. First downs, 14-4, Houston in command. That pretty much reflects the ball game. I was going to say, though, Kevin, Houston really has not shown the killer instinct this year. Last week, for instance, way out in front of Pittsburgh, they let Pittsburgh back in the ballgame. The Maulers came back strong in the second half. They were not happy about that, and I'm sure that is something they're thinking about and talking about right now, and they did so in the locker room, about, hey, let's go after these guys. Let's go after the jugular and put them away, and don't let them come back in this ballgame and make it a tight thing.
Well, first of all, I think those statistics represent all of the first quarter and the early part of the second quarter. I don't think those statistics reflect the later part of the second quarter. Oklahoma played a much better type of football towards the later part of the second quarter. Their defense started to come alive a little bit. And what you say about Houston and the killer instinct, being behind makes you mad. And when you get mad, you play better. And if you're going to get ahead of a team and make them mad, you can expect they're not going to walk off the field. These guys are professionals. They're going to play harder. So I think we can look for Oklahoma, if they have the personnel and they can do it, they're going to try as hard as they can to get back in this game.
That is Clarence Ferdinand. Back to receive for Houston. Efren Herrera will use the right leg to begin the second half here at the Astrodome in Houston, Texas. Used to call it the 8th wonder of the world. Coming down at the 15-yard line. That is perfect. Spins out of one tackle. 20, 25, hits for the sideline. Gets around another man. Now the 30-yard line. Let me tell you something. Vince has got himself some moves, huh? 15-yard run.
Well, I tell you, that was Verdan, right? Number 89, was it Verdan? And he's just a little guy. 5'8", 160 pounds. Whoops, it was Corville. Okay, Corville, the same guy. If you're going to be little, he's a little guy. Same guy as had the return last time. If you're going to be little, you better be quick.
Find out how the grid shapes up for next Sunday's race. Jim Kelly First pass of the second half is complete. That is Sanders. Chucks and jives his way to the 34-yard line. Sanders, a real talent. He and Johnson have got to have a little bit of a competition going between them. They're 1-3, Johnson and Sanders in the USFL, as you see the penalty against Houston. And they were thin coming into the ball game, about 50 yards apart in total yardage. And I bet there's a friendly rivalry there that's developed over the course of the year.
You touched on a very important point here when we were talking early here as we came back from the half, and that's a concentration thing and the killer instinct. When you're playing football and you're fat and happy with a 21-point lead or an 18-point lead,
unsportsmanlike conduct, number 67, offense.
That's the same.
Still first down.
That's Khalil. As I was saying, when you're fat and happy and you got an 18-point lead, it's hard to get revved up. And as I said, you have to be mad to play this game. You got to go out there mad. You can't run around and throw your body at people if you're happy. And Houston's got to be happy with an 18-point lead, and Oklahoma's got to be really pretty disturbed, and I'm sure that nothing happened in the locker room to make them happy. You can bet on that. So when you talk about killer instinct, there's reasons for that. And a team that gets ahead quickly and can stay ahead for a while generally will have a letdown. It's a natural human thing.
And I'm sure Oklahoma is getting very tired of getting blown out. It's happened four consecutive weeks. It could happen again today. That is Kelly throwing near side to Mosier at the 30-yard line. Some discussion there.
To me like his hands were on top of the ball, which is a key thing here. Now, in order to save this thing and make the official think he caught it, his hands would have to be under the ball. But see, the ball skipped just a little bit, and he caught it, put his hands on top of it, and stopped it like a shortstop might on a short hop. The official right there made the call. Houston will have to go second and long.
You heard the disagreement there. We weren't real happy about it. Mosier and the was saying he had it. Replay shows differently. Just begun the second half here at the Astrodome. 21-3. Gamblers in front. Second down and 20. Kelly. Nothing. Curtis Anderson made the deflection.
Jim tried to throw it under Curtis Anderson's hand. Arm. And
a little dangerous.
Yeah, that's when you have little receivers, you can do that, you know. You can throw under people's arms and still hit them in the head. But Curtis put his hand out and stopped that one.
Curtis is enjoying a fine afternoon.
Oklahoma is playing pretty well. Later part of the first half, their defense started. Remember, they got 21 points. 14 of those were very early in the game. And there's Woody, and you can bet old Woody. Woody had some things to say at halftime. 14 of those points came early in the game, and then one touchdown early in the second quarter. We thought it was going to be a 50-point ball game, and Oklahoma has pretty much stopped it.
Defense had been their hallmark much of the season, and they built up that 6-2 record. Kelly Fowler, the block, up to the 24. Bob Nelson is there to make the stop, and Houston's going to have to punt it away. So the momentum at the end of the first half defensively for Oklahoma has continued here early in the third, able to stop Houston's offense at least on the first possession. Dale Walters will come on to punt it away for Houston. Lonnie Harris is back along with Jack Steptoe to receive. High kick, not terribly deep. Fair catch at the 42. Oklahoma going to take it over, see if they can't turn this ball game around. Next Sunday, here's what the slate looks like in the USFL. Philadelphia at Michigan, Birmingham at the Breakers in New Orleans. Washington will be at Pittsburgh to take on the Maulers. Games to be covered by ABC have not yet been determined, so watch your local TV listeners. Find out what game will be on in your area. First and 10, 43-yard line. Oklahoma's first offensive possession, second half. Williams, pressure, throws it off, and I believe we're going to get a grounding. No, they're going to call him down on the sack, I believe, back at the 33-yard line as Williams sits down, looks around, and says, hey, That shouldn't happen. Tony Fitzpatrick comes in strong. He's had a heck of a game.
Got to get away from this play action. Nobody's fooled on the play action. Look at as they just push people back towards Williams. His own lineman on their back and his running back on his back there in front of him. And Doug does the only thing he can do, and that's dump the ball.
Doug in the first half, only 5 of 15 for 57 yards and an interception. Quite a contrast from last week's 4 touchdowns and 378 yards. Had a step-toe in motion. The give to Ernest Anderson. Tries to drive those legs ahead. Gets up to about the 38-yard line. Now let's check in on the sidelines and Jerry Parks. Jerry?
What has turned it around for you?
Well, they're pretty much a passing team, and they roll out. And I feel I can beat the offensive tackle because he's trying to take my outside away, and I beat him inside those 2 sacks I got. And we just got to play a little better defense in order to win the game.
You're not out of this ball game yet?
Not yet. Not yet.
Curtis Anderson on the sideline so far. 3 sacks and for some more. Back up to you, Corey.
Thank you, Jerry. Curtis Anderson is still confident, Kevin. Williams, he's going to run, drops the football. That's a live football. Who's got it? Looks like it is recovered by Oklahoma. Alvin Powell jumps on top of it at about the 35-yard line. Tony Fitzpatrick, the man chasing down Williams out there.
Well, if Doug gets away from this tackle right here, good spin by Fitzpatrick as he spins outside, get his hands on the ball. If Doug got away from that tackle, there's a lot of room upfield. He could have turned up and run the ball. Instead, it's a punting situation.
Have not seen Doug run very much today, if at all, and he is a good runner. So De Bruin is in once again. Booms it up. Comes to the near side. Bounces at about the 33-yard line. Where Houston will take over again. We've got 11:30 to go in the third quarter. Our score, Houston 21, the Outlaws 3. They are having a good time at the Astrodome today, at least thus far. They're gamblers ahead, 21-3. We've got 11:30 to go in the third quarter. They give to Fowler from Williams, and Fowler plows ahead to the 37-yard line. You got to love the way the guy runs. Terry Beeson is there on the tackle. You know, Beeson is an interesting story, Kevin. Played for Seattle for 4 years. He has the all-time career season and game record for tackles with the Seahawks. And 2 weeks ago, he missed a game against New Jersey because of back spasms. The first game in his entire career, professional, collegiate, or high school, he ever missed a game, which I find unbelievable.
For a linebacker, especially.
Right. 5. Kelly over the middle, right at midfield. That is McNeil. Good for the first down, and he took a shot when he caught the ball.
The thing so special about that play is the communication between these guys. I mean, Kelly just kind of lofted that thing up in traffic, and he knew exactly where the receiver was going to be. I think as you play this offense over and over again, we talked about it earlier, you become one personality. The entire defense takes on the personality of Darrell Davis, the offensive coordinator, and it just works. There's no question the darn thing works.
Houston, Oklahoma territory. Draw play, Fowler. Tries to burst through a hole. Moves up for about 2. Vic Koning is there. Wraps his arm around him.
Linebacker has to check and make sure the quarterback passes the back. Now look at Beeson. He's checking. He sees it. He gets forward momentum. Sheds that block real nice. Knocks the offensive man down and gets in on the tackle. That's what experience will do for you. Draw play is playing the draw play well is a product of a lot of experience. Being around, being able to recognize the play as early as possible.
Beeson, the leader, the veteran, the captain on this defensive team. Oklahoma, there's a big defensive play. Guys like Rule in there. Stopping Fowler for a loss. Good play.
One of the things about this play that's odd is Fowler was run up on his back. You don't see that too often. This was actually a running play. This was not a draw, but a running play, and Fowler just nowhere to go, and he got a little extra there as he went down. A little reminder that they're winning.
But you never want to forget when you're playing on defense against the team that's out in front by 18 points.
guys, and Herb Williams came up like a shot and stopped him. Take a look at this. Watch how quick Kelly, he's looking right at him, gets rid of the ball. It's meant to be like a short running play. The ball's a little bit ahead of him. He has to turn around, and Williams is coming.
Fourth and one, and the Gamblers are gambling. Fowler. Bullen. I don't know. It's going to be close. All depends on where the ball is spotted.
Little guy in that defense is Bob Nelson, the nose guard. His responsibility is to stop that center. Anderson was in on it. He got in that. You take an inside rush, you know. You have those three or four defensive linemen. When it's short yardage, you take an inside rush, get in the gaps, get low, make them pile it up, and there was nothing but a brick wall for Fowler.
So the ball goes over. Fowler does not get the first down yardage, and for the second straight time here in the third quarter, Oklahoma's defense has come on tough. 8 minutes left in the third quarter. Let's see if the offense doesn't get inspired from the defensive performance. That is Lazarus, right side. Slides through for a couple. Cleveland Crosby signaling Houston has the ball. Referee says, you're mistaken.
Outlaws defense is up now. These guys are excited. They've stopped him now late second quarter, early in the third quarter. They've had about three or four excellent defensive series. And now it's up to Doug Williams in the offense. They're going to get down, that defense, if their offense doesn't move the ball, stay on the field for a while, get some first downs. They need some hope. Can we win this game? And that's what Doug Williams got to accomplish right here.
Thornton and Ragsdale in the I formation. Fakes it to Ragsdale. Jerry Parks on the sideline. See what's happening down there. Jerry?
We just got late word on Lonnie Williams, the fine Oklahoma Outlaw wide receiver who was injured a bit earlier in the late in the second half. He has several bruised ribs on the left side. Nothing is broken according to x-rays, but he will not be back today. Corey?
All right, Jerry. Thanks for that report. Sets up a third and five for Oklahoma and Doug Williams. Yards short of the first down.
Very important that Oklahoma on two big plays today, both times they went to Ernest Anderson. Not a big guy, but a good effort on that play. Turned his head upfield and tried to get that yardage.
Says a lot about what they think about Ernest Anderson. Next week, USFL football right here on ABC. Philadelphia at Michigan or Birmingham at New Orleans. 2:30 times, 2:30 Central Time. A couple of goodies there. Looking, punt. Sanders at the five. Fakes left, goes right, got some room. 15-yard line. Little stutter step to the 20. There's a flag. A little bit of extracurricular activity down there. 47-yard punt, 16-yard return. And Sanders made a lot out of nothing there.
Well, the contain man lost contain for the Outlaws. He got inside. Sanders gave him a little fake, and he almost got up the sideline.
See a little bit of frustration showing the personal foul there in Oklahoma. It's got to be tough when you're down 21-3. They'd like to come back. We'll have more in a moment. Oklahoma's Tony Hayes called for unsportsmanlike conduct on that punt return. So we can see it here. Ooh.
Tony got right up, though.
Right away. 36-yard line, Houston. Fowler, good opening there. Plows up to about the 46-yard line. Houston's offensive line doing a job. Eighth inning. Cubbies lead the Astros by a score of 8-3. USFL update. We got Tampa Bay leading New Orleans 24-17. That ball game is in the third quarter. Also, the Gunslingers continue to lead the Federals 20-7. Also a third quarter score. It's 21-3 here. Gamblers over the Outlaws. Fowler again. This time, not as much room, but he does have the first. Also today, the Express in the third quarter are now ahead of the Panthers by a 14-10 score. Now, if that would hold up, the Panthers would lose. And if Houston continues to lead this ball game and wins it, Houston would be all alone on top of the Central Division of the Western Conference. First down on that Fowler run. He has 16 carries, 75 yards. Continues to impress. A 4.5 average so far today. Redan. My fault. Clarence Redan there. His program is being brought to you as an exclusive presentation of ABC Sports. Now let's pause 5 seconds to allow our local stations to identify themselves.
This is WFAA-TV, Channel 8, Dallas-Fort Worth.
All right. Kelly fakes once, then throws. A reception at the 30 by Richard Johnson. He's got the first down. Kerry Beeson is there to make the stop.
It's almost criminal that Kelly can pump on these plays. I mean, it's tough enough to guard these guys, but if he's going to have time to pump like that and get everybody on the defense to run in the wrong direction. Ooh, look at that catch. These guys got quick hands.
Good athlete.
Like a frog going after a fly on that one. He just snatched it right up.
Faust Davis says that Johnson is perhaps the smartest player he's got on this offense. Has really picked up the scheme of things exceptionally well.
You have to be a nuclear physicist to understand this offense.
Hey, Mouse was talking to us about it last night. I'm going to tell you. It is complicated. Fowler, big opening. Cuts back to the 18. Holy cow. Dick Coding is there. And Houston is moving the football via the ground and through the air.
One of the things about the draw play is it sets up easy blocking assignments. It's almost like a pass block, and all you're trying to do is turn people. See number 67 there, Frank Khalil, as he turned his man outside, and Fowler just reads the way the defense goes. And then look at Williams saying, oh my goodness, I have to block. They hit this guy, he weighs 230 pounds, and I'm just a slight 209.
Meanwhile, Fowler is salivating, saying, I'm coming at you, buddy.
Yeah, here I come, yeah.
First and 10, 17-yard line. Kelly, the give to Fowler. He's got three guys all over him. Goodlow is there. Royal is there. Casey just joined us. Jim Kelly with three touchdown passes in the first half. Got Houston out to a very quick start. They led 21-0. An Efren Herrera field goal in the second quarter made it 21-3. That is where we stand now. Kelly on the year with 31 touchdown passes. He is the USFL record holder in that department and in many others as well. Kelly flips it off. This is Fowler. He's going to score easily. Do have a penalty flag, and it may come back.
It's the same penalty. It's illegal receiver downfield, and the same play, the screen play. Oklahoma came in with five or six defensive backs on that play, and they rushed Kelly, and they had the perfect play called, but a lineman just slipped a little bit too far downfield, I believe.
Ineligible receiver downfield, number 72 offense, loss of down.
Look at this call. It's perfect. They're sending all the troops on this thing. Fowler slips through. Kelly with the pump. Now, that's what may have caused the play. Might have made the lineman go downfield. You see 70, well, 60, maybe a little further.
That's Dawson, 72. He may be the guilty player.
He was down, though. I mean, Dawson is down. Don't you have to be running around down there? Or...
Yeah, I think you're right. Let's see what they... Official did say 72, apparently. So it was Dawson. Whether he was down or not, he got the...
sack he got to call. Third and 18. Kelly, he's got a man. Others throws him. There was McNeil there about the 10-yard line, and Kelly is about 12 inches too low with that football.
It was almost like the old umbrella defense where you cover everybody on the perimeter and deep, and you leave the middle open. Kelly had a good shot at him and missed him.
I'm sure he feels like he should have had him. Tony Fritsch is coming on for his first field goal attempt of the day. He hit on four field goals last week. Also hit his longest to 42. This one will be 42 as well. Will equal his longest of the year. Tony's a real favorite, as you can tell from the crowd reaction. Kick is up. Good. And good by a mile. So, Tony Fritsch gets his 10th field goal in 12 tries on the year. And Houston has added three more points to their lead. It is now 24-3 Gamblers. You know, one of the interesting things about Tony Fritsch and Efren Herrera, they both played back in 1975 and 6 for Dallas, and they had to compete for a job. In fact, as it turned out, Efren Herrera outplayed Fritsch for the kicking job at Dallas in 76 and won that job away from Tony Fritsch. They know each other real well, I am sure, a couple of veterans.
Crowd, and they're really into the game.
Yeah,
too.
They are
into the game.
Good lively crowd. I'm impressed with the Astrodome. It's 19 years old. It's in good shape. I saw a baseball game here back in 1965. One of the first baseball games ever played here. Huge thrill. Lonnie Harris. It is quick. Driving across the 30 out of the 34-yard line. Back in 65, the very first dome stadium ever. Multi-purpose. Cost about $31 million, I believe, which would be a bargain and a half these days, let me tell you.
You could get five of them.
You could. Got a minute 29 to go here in the third quarter. And if Oklahoma wants to get back here, they better get on the move here soon. 24-3 the score. Williams, who has not enjoyed a good day, still up to controls. Zips it out. Intercepted at the 40-yard line. That is Will Lewis. The ball was intended for Al Williams, I believe. And Houston got the football back near the 40. And Williams is suffering through a horrible night.
One of the first things you learn defensively is to read the quarterback's eyes and his shoulders. Look at Williams. He looks right at the receiver and he turns his shoulders right at him. Lewis just steps in front of it. I mean, I almost jumped out of the booth here when he looked like that with his head. As soon as he turns his eyes, you're supposed to go defensively, and that was just great defense. And Doug just having a rough day. The entire Oklahoma offense has had just a real bad time. But the defense, since early in the second quarter, has played very well.
Very well. Less than a minute to go in the first quarter. Kinds of time. Watch it now. He goes down at midfield. Tackled by Bob Nelson, number 65. Nose tackle. Nelson is a big guy, 6'3", 256. And they tell us he's a big outdoorsman. And one of his favorite habits, believe it or not, Kevin, is to hunt wild boar with a machete.
One of my favorites, too. If you haven't tried it, don't knock it, Corey.
If it's a small boar, I'll think about it with a big machete, but, you know.
I think Kelly is getting a little bit of time, but the coverage has been much, much better by Oklahoma, and you just can't find receivers. The defensive backs are doing a real good job covering this offense.
Kelly flips it off. The pressure was on. Fowler up and across the 40-yard line of the 38. Terry Beeson is there. They were coming. And Kelly flipped it off just in time.
That's communication. I'll tell you, Fowler, they just have that thing going where Kelly feels the pressure. Fowler knows he's in trouble, and he's slipping outside and catching that short pass.
And there is the gun to signal the end of the third quarter of play. Houston with the football in Oklahoma territory. They lead by a score of 24-3. Next week, Houston will travel to Jacksonville. As for Oklahoma, they finally get home. First of three games at home. They've been on the road four consecutive weeks, and I'm sure they can't wait to play in the friendly confines of Skelly Stadium once again in Tulsa. Our score at the end of three quarters is 24-3. Can the Outlaws come back? We'll find out. Gamblers lead 24-3. Apparently we experienced some audio difficulties there for the past few minutes. We're told we are back at full speed. Kelly, look out, he is hit from behind, a blindside Rod McMillan. And Kelly is sacked for the sixth time today. Did not see that one coming.
That's defensive back from the backside there, and they're doing it. They're making Kelly pull up, and they're giving him pressure from the backside. Good defense by Oklahoma.
Stats after three quarters. Look at the total yardage, 345-96. Turnovers, 3-0 in favor of, or not really in favor of, but Oklahoma leading in that category. The time of possession, quite a contrast there. Nearly 30 minutes to 15, Houston to Oklahoma. Dale Walters into punt for Houston. Jack Steptoe and Lonnie Harris. Great kick. Hits at the goal line. Actually, too good of a kick. Wanted inside the five, I'm sure. That's a punt of 47 yards. Walters has boomed a few out of here today. 14:23 to go. And the time is now for Oklahoma to get something together here.
That's right. Fourth quarter. When you start the fourth quarter, you stand on the sideline, you think about the fact, it's the fourth quarter. When you're in the third quarter, you're down a touchdown or two or three, and you think, well, I have time. There's no more time. These guys have to do something offensively. They have to score. The whole team knows it now. And sometimes it'll bring your adrenaline level up a little bit. Let's see if it does for the Outlaws.
Ernest Anderson, gain of about 3 yards. Still having some technical difficulties. We're going to switch to Tampa Bay and New Orleans and pick up that ball game in progress right now with a score, Houston 24, Oklahoma 3.
Jim Mazzetti, place kicker turned passer with Jim Bergamo.
All right, Tim, everybody wants to know what happened exactly on that play. It looked like you were confused, but I'm sure it was planned.
No, it was planned, Jim. It's a sandlot play. It's called the fake tee field goal. I run in without the tee. Look at Nolan. Nolan does an excellent job of acting. He comes running to the sideline and says, where there's a tee? And he's the man in motion on the quarterback set in the shotgun position. I just hit him on a pattern going down the line. Tampa Bay made a great play. Should have been a touchdown.
A little bit of pass next time, Tim, and it might be. Boone goes for the first down on a handoff up the middle, and I don't think he made it. Looks like the spot is well short of it as Jeff Merrill bangs in there. Those have been watching Houston, Oklahoma. We're at Tampa Bay. I'm sorry you've had troubles with that ball game, but I'm sure they'll get things organized out there sooner or later. Here in Tampa Bay, our score, the Bandits 24 and the New Orleans Breakers 17. New Orleans was down inside the 20 and was turned away by the Bandits defense. Now Tampa Bay looking at fourth and about a yard, and we're about to have our first punt in this football game.
Stop him!
I think. There's no punter out there. Leading by only a touchdown against an explosive New Orleans team, Steve Spurrier is showing you some grit.
Ooh,
he is saying to his offensive team at their own 27-yard line on fourth and one, go for it. Ah, that's what he was doing. He was just trying to go up there and take a long count, try to drive him offside or something like that, and watch the clock run out at the end of the third quarter. But we'll be back with the final period between the Breakers and the Bandits after this message and the word from our local station. Tampa Bay 24, New Orleans 17. First punt of the ball game is coming up now. Zenon Androzition, he will kick the football toward Woodrow Wilson, number 20, and Nolan Franz, number 84. You don't want the ball to bounce here. The kick is away. It is short. It does bounce. Franz, however, steps away from one man and accepts the ball and then returns it to the New Orleans 43, where Chris Foote brings him down. So trailing by 7 points. A little pressure shifts over to Johnny Walton and company as they come on the field. You see the stats for three quarters now in our ball game here at Tampa.
It's even everywhere down the line except in time of possession and points on the scoreboard to the Bandits lead 24-17.
But New Orleans with almost a full quarter to work now go first down from their own 43. And Johnny Walton back to throw. A little swing out here to Marcus Dupree. And Dupree is caught from behind by Dwayne Anderson, who has come in to play a heck of a football game for the Bandits. Tony Good, the kick returner for New Orleans, has been sent off for x-rays. And now his chest because of that lick that he took to John Benson.
The two licks he took.
Yeah.
Two in a row. Almost the exact same place on his chest and the sideline.
There was no gain of any consequence on that little dump pass out to Dupree. So it's second down and 10. Dupree trying to get outside. There's no chance. They bury him back behind the line of scrimmage with Fred McAllister and Mike Clark and a penalty flag at the line of scrimmage. And you got a holding coming up against New Orleans.
On the offense, declined, third down.
Jerry Raymond, the left guard, offensive guard.
Second time today, he's been dinged.
What, beg your pardon?
Second time.
Second time?
Mm-hmm. Dupree losing on that play, 6 yards. That takes him back under 100 net. You're looking at third down and 16. So they've got all the pass catchers in there. Shotgun. Walden's pass, no good, out of bounds. Marion Brown, number 82, was out of bounds when the ball got there.
He wouldn't have a chance, and Jeff George came over, left cornerback, and really gave him a good lick for insurance.
Now New Orleans will punt for the first time today. Alvin Bailey goes back, and the story on number 25, he has returned 72 consecutive punts.
That means good blocking out in front and a courageous heart.
Dario Casarino can't get it to turnover. It's sort of wobbling around, and he fumbles the ball. New Orleans looked like they had a shot at it.
Here's the customary pileup where no one seems to know for sure. Looks like an official is getting ready to point.
It's New Orleans.
New Orleans.
A hanging 34-yard punt that got up in the wind. It didn't turn over at all, so it started backing up on Alvin Bailey, and that's the hardest kind of a ball in the world to track down when the thing is sliding away from you. And it just bounced out of his arms.
Take a look there. He didn't call it. He had to run up for it. The ball was sliding away from him. That's a tough catch. He's got to really get under that. Get both hands in his chest there. He just slid right through his arm.
That is the fourth turnover now for Tampa Bay. Ben Needham recovered the ball, and the Breakers get a break.
He likes a weak side action with an eight.
Let's see now if Dick Corey can get his offensive team to capitalize on it.
They've been pretty quiet this second half.
Very quiet.
Of course, their first two possessions were fumbles, and they didn't have the ball.
From the 32 of Tampa. Walton going big for Lockett. He's got it at the 9. And there's a tough kid from Nebraska.
Well, when Marcus Dupree came to the New Orleans Breakers, he said the most impressive thing he saw on that team was Frank Lockett's arms. He is built very much like a linebacker at 6 feet, 200 pounds. He has been in that weight room quite a bit. Look at the hit that number 28, Doug Bedoyan, lays on him right there. You see the whole bottle just shakes, wobbles, but one thing stays steady and calm, his hands around the football. He brings it in.
And it's first and goal, New Orleans, at the Tampa Bay 9. Dupree on a sweep to the 6. Dwayne Anderson had got it.
That was not a real strong move.
No, wasn't it?
By Dupree to come inside. He had a blocker out in front of him, Mark Shaleen, and he was blocking on Dwayne Anderson, and instead of just seeing that block set up, taking the inside hard, he took a slight angle. Mark Shaleen was able to play off the blocks.
One of the linemen down there, I don't know whether 65 or 64 or 62, but there is a New Orleans lineman down on the field. Time is called for him with 11 minutes and 58 seconds to play in the football game. It's Jerry Raymond out of Boston College who is shaken up on the play. So you've got a timeout for the injured player as New Orleans is trying to get in and tie it up.
Jim Lampley again in New York. Those of you who were watching Oklahoma and Houston, here's the latest gambler touchdown, a 4-yard run by Todd Fowler. That stretched it, of course, to 31-3 in favor of the gamblers. Kelly, 20 of 31 for 281 yards, and Coach Jack Pardee has had his backup, Todd Dillon, warming up. Back to Keith Jackson.
Thank you, Jimmy. It is a fine summer day on Tampa Bay.
Well, taking advantage of a little bit of bench space up in the upper levels.
Oklahoma, 3.
The ball is at the 6-yard line of Tampa Bay in the possession of New Orleans. They're trying to tie it up or even perhaps go for 2 and go ahead. Second down and goal. Walton hands that ball to Dupree, breaks tackles and goes down close to the 1. That showed me a little strength.
That showed me some strength, but it didn't show me very much quickness, Keith. Nope. He had a blitz, looking right at the blitz. Walton keeps the play on. Now, Dupree has to get this ball and just take off and run past those linemen who are trying to get upfield looking for a pass. You know, he gets hit, he drives, uses the power, almost makes it in there, but with a little bit more quickness, he could have been in there clean.
Ball is on the 2 for its third down and goal to go. Just needs to be a little more aggressive.
We got Wayne Cross.
And he's learning.
Up and over.
Walton throws and almost threw an interception. Number 51, Kelly Kirchbaum, stepped in front of David Bale and almost came out of there with an interception.
Oh, boy.
It was a terrible pass.
He almost loses the ball faking the handoff. Watch right here. He fakes it to Dupree. Right there, he almost lost the ball. Then he comes back. There's a linebacker right in front, number 51, Kelly Kirchbaum. A little bit better hands.
Well, they're going to go for the field goal. They make it 24-20. It's a 19-yard kick by Mazzetti. He's missed one and hit one today. He's now 2 out of 3. If that kick is good. So with 10 minutes and 44 seconds to play in the ball game, it is now 24-20. Tampa Bay still leads New Orleans.
Big guy out of Iowa, we're told he looks like a keeper in 2 days of practice this week. He looked like the best guy out there as Williams hits Wheeler for the first down at about the 38-yard line. Lavelis just signed earlier in the week. He was a 6th-round draft pick by the Dallas Cowboys in the NFL draft. The Outlaws able to sign him this past week, and they're very happy about him. Number 75, senior picture right there next to Ron Wheeler.
And that was Wheeler. He's the leading receiver. That was his second catch of the day, and the first one came on a broken play. So Houston's done an excellent job on the key players. Lovellis, as you see him on the screen, you'll see a lot of him.
Look at his arms.
They say he was the best lineman in camp this week, and it was his first week.
First down, Williams going long for Steptoe. Oh, got to be a little bit of an interference down there with Big Steptoe's angry about it. Kevin, what do you think?
I was watching the official, and it looked like as he was running down the field, he was reaching for his flag. And he never did. He never did get it. Never picked it up. Watch the official short here. You can't see him. But that looks like a little offensive interference there as he puts his hand on the defender. At any rate, it's not really going to help with a, 19-point lead.
Mike Mitchell, the man defending for Houston. Doug Williams, not the kind of stats he can be very proud of. 9 of 26. Good pass, far side to his buddy Al Williams. Another first down. Will Lewis makes the tackle. Let's now go down to the sidelines and Jerry Parks. Jerry?
We're here with Todd Fowler. Todd, great football game. You feel good about it. They said you liked to hit. You got hit pretty good.
Yeah, I sure did. Oklahoma really comes up strikes, and my offensive line's been doing a good job punching some holes for me.
Two touchdowns today, one passing, one rushing. This doubled your performance this season.
It sure did. I need to have a big game, and I guess the line helped me come through tonight.
Todd, a big game for you and a big game for the Gamblers. Looks like they're going to move into first place. You feel good?
We feel real good about it. We think we got a pretty good schedule coming up, and we just want to keep after them.
Good. Todd Fowler, thank you much. Corey?
All right. Thank you, Jerry. You saw the long pass intended for Williams go incomplete. Doug Williams overthrowing him.
Also good defense by Lewis on that. It was kind of position defense. What he did, the ball was thrown outside, and he just got between the receiver and the ball, kept him from cutting back outside to get it.
Remember this guy, Kev?
From Oakland, when they were in Oakland. Pretty good defensive lineman. Just signed by Houston this week.
Just signed the last couple days. Should be a big help for him. Place the pass to Sample out of the backfield. Ted Sample, another first down on about the 34-yard line. The fans in Oklahoma are very concerned about the future of the Outlaws. There's some discussion about whether they'll stay in Tulsa or maybe move on to Oklahoma City. Possibility of a dome stadium, we understand, being built in Tulsa. And we understand there could be some determination in the future of the Outlaws where they will play their football games next year by June. Williams, first and 10, lets it go under a big rush. It was underthrown.
He had the right man. That was a tight end, Wheeler, streaking down the middle, and there was no safety down there. If Doug could have kind of got it up, might have scored. It's got to be tough for Williams out there, as we said at the outset of the show. A second expansion team he's played with, and truly, sometimes the support isn't all that great. It can make you look worse. If you have a bad day, it makes you look like an awful day, and that doesn't do much for your morale. But as we also said, the people in Oklahoma like Doug Williams. The coaching staff likes him. He's an up type of guy, and he's a leader out there, and they're pleased to have him.
Second and 10, ball, the 34-yard line. The pitch to Ernest Anderson. Sees a hole, cuts back, still on his feet, across the 30-yard line where he's knocked down by Will Lewis. And we're seeing some very exciting things out of Anderson. I think Outlaw fans should be encouraged by what lies ahead with Ernest Anderson in the backfield for Oklahoma.
Something to build around, a back that can break free like that. Maybe an offensive lineman or two, and Ernest could make a difference in this offense.
I like to see Ernest run. 2-minute warning, Houston 31, Outlaws 12. Corey McFerrin, Kevin Kiley, and Jerry Parks back at the Astrodome in Houston, where the Gamblers have a 31-12 lead with just 2 minutes remaining in the ballgame. And Kevin Kiley, I'm sure you've been in this situation a few times. 2 minutes to go in the game. It's out of control. What do you do to stay in the game and keep motivated and keep playing hard? Is that difficult?
Well, it's an emotional game, and you have to be hitting people. And this is what the type of film coaches like to look at. They find out which guy is really tough and just likes to play for the sake of running around and hitting people, or who's playing for money, very frankly, and just wants to take it easy.
Anderson again. Pumping those legs ahead, and he's across for the first down, I do believe.
I'd have to say they must be pretty pleased with Ernest Anderson, because this game is out of reach. An offensive back, sometimes they put their head down, they have a high risk probability of being hurt. Anderson's played very well late in this game.
Ernest is not a big guy. He is 5'11". They list him 190 pounds. That's Diawa down. They're attending to some kind of an injury.
I used to hate to play against guys like that. The shorter guy, you have to get way down. A lot of times, if you play linebacker or defensive back, you wind up catching them in your stomach, and that's bad. It hurts after a while. The bigger guys, sometimes you can get under them, but the little guys, they use their size against you.
Sure. Jim Kelly with the elbow wrapped. He's had that bruise. We saw him go down on one of those sacks where it looked like he got him bumped up a little bit. I'm sure that's a cause for some concern, but right now with that smile on his face, it doesn't appear to be a major problem. Got to be a nice feeling to be on the sideline and know that your day is over and you're ahead 31-12. You've thrown for three touchdowns. You've passed for 287 yards. You're the finest rookie quarterback in football. Yard line. Hollis Hall drives him out.
I think one of the oddities of this game is that while Kelly is the number one passer in the league, he doesn't have the most attempts. Doug Williams has the most attempts. So coming into this game, he had thrown the ball 450 times, while Kelly, who passes nearly on every down, had thrown the ball about 430 times. What is it?
About 417.
417 times. And interestingly enough, for 417 yards a game total offense, that was their average. So Williams has been behind a lot, throwing the ball.
Exactly.
Quite a bit.
I saw Tony Fritz relaxing on the sidelines a minute ago, using his helmet as a convenient school. Williams is down. Tommy Myers out of the backfield. Tommy is more or less the sack specialist out of the secondary. Came into the game with 3.5 sacks.
Myers did a great thing there. Myers is a veteran, knows the game's out of reach, and he catches Doug Williams. Let's take a look at this. Williams, he has a great shot at Williams. Look what he does. He doesn't bury him. He just kind of catches him and holds him up and waits for the referee to blow the whistle. And you got to take your hat off to Myers. Williams, high-priced talent, good football player, and a heck of a guy, and there's no point in blasting him in that situation.
Fifth sack of the game for Houston. We've had 14 altogether. That's quite a few. 31-12. Houston's got it. We've got a minute and 29 remaining here in the fourth quarter. We'd like to thank our spotter, Bill Frio, and our stats man, Joe Cox, as always, an expert performance. Appreciate it. It's Doug Williams. To the line as time begins to tick away here. The final minute and a half. It's Otha Hill in motion. Ernest Anderson hits the hole very hard. Caton is there to stop him. He really does hit that hole quickly. Obviously no place to go there, but gets out of the blocks fast.
Well, the problem with the offensive backs on this team was that they were little, but they weren't quick. And
that's terrible.
That's right.
Yeah.
You've got the bad combination there for a little. You better be quick. And Ernest Anderson, he'll help this team. This team's got some personnel problems. They lost some people on the defense due to injuries. That kind of started their slide. And they do have problems with the continuity on their offense. But you need quality people. It takes time to build a program. And, hey, this team's won 6 games this year. This is an expansion outfit. And they started off out of the blocks real well, but the league's kind of caught up with them the last few weeks. It'll come.
And they've played some tough clubs the last month as well. Remember that. Doug Williams, I'm sure he is anxious for this game to end. Got the helmet back. Looks a little weary. It's a reserve tight end, Price, Jerry Price, at the bottom of your screen. Doug Williams. And I mentioned before, he threw 93 touchdowns in college over the four-year career. Kevin, he had, 38 touchdowns in his senior season, which is a pretty good total.
He was fourth in the Heisman Trophy voting his senior year. That says a heck of a lot. Grambling, not a big school.
Strong guy, 6'4", 220. He will return. Williams firing the bullet pass inside the 10 to Al Williams. And Oklahoma would like very much to at least score one more time before this ball game is history.
This is the thing about Doug Williams, it's so difficult to understand. He can have a game like this that's so bad, and then he can turn around and step up in the pocket and rifle it in the chest of a guy who's guarded pretty well defensively. He has tremendous talent and great potential.
Williams lofting in the end zone. It is picked off. Joe Heath, and that pretty much reflects the story today. Every time anything good happened for Oklahoma offensively, it's been messed up in the end. There's a flag on the play, but it appears to be against Oklahoma. Wait and find out for sure.
It's perfect defensive position by Heath. You know, those things are timing patterns.
Number 77 offense.
There's Heath. You just loft those things into the end zone and you hope that your offensive man can run under it. And Heath just happened to be there. He was in perfect position. The ball was as far as it could go without going out of bounds, and that's where you want to throw it. And Heath picked it up. There's, I guess a picture's worth a thousand words. That about tells it.
See, I don't believe this day. Let me out of here. So JoJo Heath makes the interception. First and 10 from the 20 for Houston. A minute 6 to go. Again, that is Dillon in quarterback for Houston. And Darrell Clark is in the ball game for the first time. Darrell just signed this past week. University of Texas standout, 5'11", 194 pounds. In fact, he's the first player since Earl Campbell to rush for over 1,000 yards at Texas. They're high on him.
You know what you look for on defense now? You look for the guy that wants to call timeout so they'll run another play. If you can find that guy, you make him defensive captain.
Is that the kind of player you were? Let's keep it going despite the score.
I was the guy that put the gag in the guy's mouth that said that.
That's Clark again for a couple. We're under 20 seconds. I think we might have found that guy, Kevin.
Yeah, sign him up. What a guy, right?
It is a timeout.
I love it.
That's for some reason, that's funny.
I think that's great. I love that. Give me one more shot at this guy. I don't care what the score is. If you get a few guys like that, you'll win some games.
Shall we give this guy a bonus, you think, Kevin?
These games tell a lot to a coach. You'd be surprised. There's a lot of value. You don't like to lose, but there's a lot of value on film. You see guys get beat, but there's a lot of guys out there that aren't getting beat for Oklahoma. Those are the guys you build a team around. And the guy that goes four quarters when they're losing 21-0 is the guy you want.
Jack Pardee has reason to smile. This one tucked away long ago. 16 seconds to go. And if Michigan would lose their ball game today with the Los Angeles Express, this victory today by Houston catapults them into the first place spot of the Central Division of the Western Conference all by themselves. And that is going to do it. Jack Pardee and company have just won their 8th ball game on the year. 31-12, the Gamblers over the Outlaws. Once again, the final score, Houston 31, Oklahoma 12. Back at the Astrodome in Houston, Corey McFerrin, Kevin Kiley, and Jerry Parks. The Houston Gamblers, a winner convincingly here, 31-12, the final score. The Outlaws losing their 5th consecutive game. Houston going to 8-5. Oklahoma's record now at 6-7. And the Outlaws, despite the game, the score you see there, there were some bright spots. Kevin, I would point out, too, the play from Curtis Anderson, the sacks they're able to make against Jim Kelly, 9 altogether. And secondly, Ernest Anderson and the possibility of Ernest becoming a major factor on this Oklahoma ball club.
Anderson played well, and the defense did play well for, probably from the early second quarter on, they played a whale of a football game against the USFL's best offense. I think Houston has to be considered one of the strengths of the league. They've lost 3 games in sudden death, and they're 8-5 anyway. I mean, this team conceivably could be 11-2 and near the top of the league. So Houston's a powerhouse, let's face it. This team is, they've got everything they need. Their defense improves every week. They were 18th 2 weeks in the league, 2 weeks ago in pass defense, and here we come in here, they're 17th, and they did a great job against Doug Williams. He couldn't throw the ball at all. So defensively, if they improve with this offense, averaging over 400 yards a game, look out. And they're headed for the playoffs.
I think the Houston Gamblers will be a team to be reckoned with before the playoff season is over. There's a very happy Jim Kelly exiting here as his club, the Gamblers, have defeated Oklahoma today, 31-12. Houston going to 8-5 on the year. Stay tuned now for the Indianapolis 500 time trials. Travel arrangements made through and a promotional fee paid by United Airlines. United flies more people to Hawaii than any other airline. Nobody knows Hawaii like United. This has been a presentation of ABC Sports.